Matthew, that's spelled T-H-I-E-U at the end, says, on Mathieu. KP24, you are very much correct, Mr. Parry. So thank you very much indeed.
Okay.
Yeah.
What's his name?
Matthew.
Mathieu.
Mathieu.
Well, he's French, they don't play cricket.
Mathieu. Well, yeah, okay, so they... Well, they do. Didn't they play in the World Cup? No, they didn't. No, that was the Irish, wasn't it?
Yeah, that was the Irish.
Differently interesting extra time communion for minicab drivers.
Take the money and sit back down again.
Breastfeeding mums.
Oh, you've not been giving it its breakfast again, have you?
And people disturbed by urban foxes engaged in the act of lovemaking behind their bins.
Anybody there?
The two mics. Overworked, overweight, overpaid, overnight. On Talk Sport.
Look at the light!
I've never said that.
Yes, you have.
I have not, you fool. You're trying to brand me like some sort of lunatic.
This is Talk Sport. We are the two mics, and very festive we are indeed right now. It's time to say a very festive good morning to Mr. Mike Porky Parry. Very good morning to you, Mr. Parry.
Yes, a very good morning to you,
Mike. You're looking a bit harassed there. What's going on with your hair?
No, I'm not harassed.
Your hair's all over the place.
No, it's not.
It's all sticking up.
No, no.
Yeah, what, have you been dragged through a hedge backwards?
No. Oh, the problem is with this... The weather at the moment being mild.
Very mild.
And
wet.
What's the word I'm looking for? The
unseasonal.
Unseasonal, certainly, but temperate. The temperate weather at
it
the
is.
Moment, okay? Temperate. What happens is, when I come out of the shower, where my body has been under intense heat of the water...
Why is it intense heat? Well, why don't you just have a normal shower?
No, I've got a power shower head, which...
Well, everybody's got a power shower now.
No.
Power showers are what you had in the 70s, most people had a shower that made
no
water pressure at all.
No, no. You've got to understand...
You haven't got one of those ones that they used to have in the old Premier Inns where you switch the shower on and it goes...
No. In my wet room, I have a nozzle feature, which...
Have you got one of those ones that comes out of the wall?
Well, no, it's attached to the ceiling, obviously, but I can adjust it.
No, but you've seen those shower cubicles where you can get the shower coming out of the wall as well, have you not?
What do you mean, out of the wall?
Well, you can get, like, you know, various different nozzle points, so you can have the one above you, but you can also have shower points. Have you ever stayed in a decent hotel in your life?
Yes, but that
where
sounds...
Where they have, like, the shower nozzle points coming out, firing all over you.
But that sounds to me more like a car wash than a shower.
Well, it's very effective.
A car wash effect, yeah.
It's very effective.
Anyway, no, it's not that. It's one particular nozzle, and this... This one is so powerful, it doesn't so much shower you as attack you.
Does it?
And,
do you like that?
Yeah, I do, because it's designed to open up the pores in your skin.
Mm.
Now, what happens is, it is very, very powerful. You come out, and I set it at
a
temperature.
Why is it so hot, though?
Well, because I want to burn off all the excess grime underneath my skin in my pores, you see.
Right.
And so when I come out...
You could just go into one of those car washes, get them to hose you down with a jet wash.
No, I think that would suit you more, because you're a fat slob. And,
well, I mean, as many people have pointed out, given the pictures that have gone around... Mm. You know, by the way, there's a new Twitter account called Two Mics on Tour.
I know, it's very cute.
I'm not hopeful about their future, though, because they've just sent us a tweet asking if we can send... what is that noise?
Well, I'm afraid I'll tell you about this in a minute. My phone keeps ringing itself. It's completely wrecked. It is completely wrecked. Not joking.
How can it ring itself?
The battery's bent in two, and if you have a look, you'll see that it's trying to burst out of the middle of the phone.
That's very odd looking.
I spent 2 hours today in a car phone warehouse, and all I got was things that they couldn't do.
Yeah.
The Vodafone system went down. They couldn't change my emails from one system to another. It was a fiasco.
Really?
We'll talk about that later.
Yeah, we'll talk about that later.
The shower thing, what happens is, when you come out, you then have raised the temperature of your skin to approximately... 27 degrees.
Really?
Now, when you get outside, and you find it's 28 or 29 degrees, your skin doesn't dry off.
Well, hang on. It's not 29 degrees at the moment.
What is it?
It's about, the highest I think it was today is about 15.
Well, 15. Okay. Yeah. Well, in that case,
about half the temperature you've just described.
In that case, my skin must have been boiling at about 14 or something like that.
Yeah.
So you come out and
boiling skin.
And you find...
It's a great ad for the shower, isn't it?
Yeah, you find
boil your own skin.
You find it's warmer than your skin temperature. So what happens is your body doesn't dry.
Mm.
So I have basically driven to work wet. seriously.
Why did you put the AC on?
What's the AC?
The air conditioning in the car.
Oh,
and just blast
no.
it at your face and then you cool yourself down.
No, that would have given me pneumonia.
No.
I've
previously dried my hair in the car. You know, hair's wet and you just turn
hair was wet and now it's all set in a strange way. But anyway, look.
Listen, we've got very important things to talk about.
We certainly
Never
have.
Mind your personal habits.
Well,
Everton
well,
in £200 million.
You asked me,
Everton,
not the other way around.
Everton in £200 million US takeover.
Yeah.
As a headline on the back page of the Times this morning. Exclusive by Rory Smith.
Yes.
Now, according to this, these are guys who have tried already to buy at least two... or buy into at least two other football clubs, including Swansea in the Premier League.
Yes.
You know much about this?
Well, what I know is that there have been several attempts to buy into Everton over the last 5 or 6 years. Mm. And if Mr. Kenwright, the chairman and owner of Everton, thinks it is a good move for the club,
yeah,
it may go ahead. But I've seen so many of these fail. I'm not doubting the story written by Rory Smith, the Times writer.
Oh, no, it looks very much as though these two guys who are sort of technology billionaires,
yes,
want to get into football in this country.
Yeah, I'm not doubting that whatsoever. Personally, I would prefer a sheikh to arrive with a billion quid and to buy us wholesale, and then we would have the sort of financial standing that Manchester City have or Chelsea have or something like that.
Yeah.
Because if you think about this, I mean, basically, the deal is that these guys come in, they take a £200 million stake in Everton.
So you think it's more of a stake than a takeover?
Well, I don't know. I don't know about this deal. Should a sale go through, it would make Everton the second Barclays Premier League side in less than 2 months to receive an injection of US capital. So it says injection.
The other one being Crystal Palace.
Crystal Palace announced this week that they had agreed to sell a 36% stake to Joshua Harris, owner of the Philadelphia 76ers,
yeah,
okay?
Right.
Now, how much money did they inject into Crystal Palace?
I'm not sure.
Exactly. Now, £400 million has also been injected into Manchester City recently.
It has.
So we're talking here about money being injected into clubs.
That was the Chinese, wasn't it?
The Chinese, indeed. Yeah. Rather than the clubs being taken over.
Yeah.
Now, all I would say is that the club on the other side of Stanley Park, which is 1.2 miles away,
Liverpool,
have been controlled by American investors for nearly a decade now. Mm. Two sets of American investors. The first who fell out with each other, couldn't make it work, Gillick and whatever
Gillette
his name
and
was.
His face, yeah.
Yeah, yeah, that's right.
Yeah, well, they weren't very popular, were they?
They weren't very popular because they didn't come up with the promise of getting a spade in the ground in 60 days to build a new stadium.
Right. Well, amongst other things.
Amongst other things, you're absolutely right. And now the current owners, you know, who are the Boston mob, right?
Fenway Sports Group.
And you have to say, Liverpool are in a much worse state now than they were when the American investors came in.
You think?
Without a shadow of a doubt. They're in turmoil.
I don't know about that.
I think Liverpool are in a bit of turmoil, to be honest. I mean, OK, if I'm being unfair, then I've picked on a bad period of Liverpool's life in that they're in transition.
Yeah.
I accept that. But they need an awful lot of quality players to become a top-four club again.
They do, but they've got Jurgen Klopp as manager.
They've got Jurgen Klopp, sure.
They're surely much better off now than they were under Gillette and Hicks, aren't they?
I don't know if they are. I mean, under Gillette and Hicks, they were like, you know, a regular top four team.
Mm.
And under, you know, the current mob, they obviously challenged for the title 2 seasons ago and didn't quite make it. And that caused, you know, them to tip over the precipice or whatever. But all I'm saying is, you know, who are the other American investors? Aston Villa.
Aston Villa have got Randy Lerman,
although
he supposedly wants to sell it.
Well, they look as though they're going to get relegated.
Yeah.
So American investors at Villa look as though they're going to get relegated. American investors at Liverpool,
yeah,
very, very indifferent sort of season, OK? And an unsure future. American investor in Arsenal,
yeah,
may have...
Cronky
might now come to it, but he's not the only investor.
Yeah.
Is
that thing still going?
Yeah, I'll explain
it
in a minute.
Can you not switch it on silent?
No, I'll explain it in a minute.
I can't have your phone vibrating all the way through the show.
Don't worry about it.
I'm not worried about it, I just don't like it.
Just try and concentrate. So what I'm saying is at Arsenal, the man with the most money in the club is a Russian, isn't he?
Yeah.
Mr. Usmanov, yeah?
Yes, that's right.
And so...
Yeah, but he's persona non grata, isn't he?
Well, exactly. But I mean, what I'm saying is not just American money. So everywhere I look and I see American money, I don't see huge success. Fulham, American investor.
Yeah.
Disaster.
What about Sunderland?
Sunderland could be disaster, look as though they're going down.
Yeah.
So I have to say, although I very much welcome a £200 million injection in Everton Football Club, from where it's coming from, I'm not at the moment jumping through the hoops. However, if Mr. Kenwright gives it his blessing...
Hmm.
And I believe him.
Yeah, but everybody says Everton need more money, right? So what's wrong with having a cash injection?
It depends what sort of money. And it depends what the conditions are on the money that you get, OK?
Yeah.
I mean, are they just going to put this money in and then over the next couple of years maybe see the bountiful rewards of a massive TV deal?
Well, I'll tell you, it's interesting.
And then disappear again.
Because John J. Moores and Charles Noel, great name for a Christmas investor, right?
Yeah.
These guys have apparently... These are the ones who have tried to get by into Swansea in the past. What they did do was buy the San Diego Padres, which is a baseball team, of course, in San Diego, and they owned it for a few years and basically made a 10 times profit on what they put in, but took out an awful lot of the TV money that was put into the baseball league.
Yeah.
So they could be just looking to get into Everton now, and then once the big money comes in next year, take loads of that as profit and move back out again.
Yeah, well, like, it could be the case.
You may have to beware.
It could be the case. If Mr. Kenwright gives it his say-so, and he regards himself as the custodian of our great club...
Yeah.
I mean, you know, if you cut Mr. Kenwright in half, he'd be like a piece of rock.
I don't think
he would say Everton through the middle.
Yeah, I think that's a good idea.
So he won't let the club go, and he won't let a huge investment like this take place unless he's absolutely sure it's good for the club.
Yeah.
If he says yes, I say yes, and I would say it's a brilliant thing because he has wanted to find an investor to take Everton on for the best part of a decade, really.
Well, we'll talk some more about this because we've got lots more to do, not least, of course, the cliffhanger that is winners and losers. Do you know that when it got to midnight, which is traditionally when the voting closes, the draw was evident. It was 50-50.
Yeah, but an hour before that, I was 51-49 up. So what did you do in the last hour to gerrymander it?
It's got nothing to do with me.
You're a thieving scoundrel.
It's got nothing to do with me.
You
what
are.
I'm suggesting,
you're a thief. You steal votes off people.
What I'm suggesting...
Steal votes off me.
What I'm suggesting, right, you were quite happy with the system last week.
I think, you
know...
You
were quite happy with the system the week before. Were you not? Were you not?
If somebody...
Were you happy with it last week?
When you leave work after this show, right, in a few hours' time...
Yeah.
I wouldn't object if somebody clubbed you to death on the on the steps of Talksport Towers.
You see, you keep it up. This way, people will be, your true nature will be revealed, and you will lose. Because what we're going to do, I've sent out a tweet now on the Two Mics account saying that the voting is now open until 3 o'clock. So
that's it.
What is that? 1 hour, 45 minutes
that's
from now.
Right. Vote often, vote Porky.
So currently it's 51% to Porky, 49% to me.
Currently it is now.
Right now, yeah.
Well, hang on, I thought you said it was 50-50 and that's why it was going 50-50 on.
50-50 at midnight.
Oh, I see. Right, we're going until three. Right,
we're going until three. Try and keep up. Try and keep up.
And somebody turn the clock forward faster. Let's get to 3 o'clock
see,
while it's 51%
kind of
in my favour.
I mean, for all those people who believe in truth, in honesty,
and
in democracy and justice and all
seeker
those things.
Seeker of truth and justice.
You know, please do the right thing and vote as much as you can for the person that you would like to win the most, who is, in your view, the most honest. This is Talk Sport.
Don't phone your mother. Phone Talk Sport.
Football. 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 On DAB Digital Radio and 1089 and 1053 AM.
Atletico Radio.
Talk Sport.
This is Talk Sport. We are the Two Mics. It's Ask Porky coming up a little bit later on. We've got loads of great questions, some of them festive, some of them not so festive, because we're very close to Christmas now, you know. So I hope you've got all your presents and everything sorted out.
I don't let Christmas cloud my daily routine.
Don't you?
And my attitude to life,
right,
which is always, if you're not winning, it's because you're not trying hard enough, OK?
Yeah, well,
you weren't winning at midnight.
You weren't winning at midnight, so we've got till 3 a.m, ladies and gentlemen, on winners and losers, because it's very, very close. Mm. And we may have to have another a recount or something at 3 o'clock. We might have to do what we did last time.
Yeah.
It was this close, which is when we had to go back to the old system of retweets and likes to see who actually is going to win it. Now, a couple of things to mention to you. Mario Melchiot's going to be coming on in a little while. He's a fellow countryman, of course, of Louis van Gaal. Now, you said last night to me that you believed that Jose Mourinho was going to be the next manager of Manchester United, right? Have you not heard the news tonight that Jorge Mendes said that there is not even an offer on the table, they're not talking to him, there is nothing going on?
Oh, what a surprise.
What do you mean it's a surprise?
Is that really what Jose's agent said?
Yeah, that's what he said.
Oh, crikey.
What are you saying? It's not true.
What a revelation.
Oh, what are you saying? You know better than... do you know better than Jose's agent?
Well,
what are you saying?
That's it. Jose's agent's made a statement. The deal's off, isn't it?
Well, no, he doesn't say the deal's off. He says there is nothing on the table.
How naive are you?
I'm saying, I'm only quoting what his agent says, which is that there is nothing on the table.
I used to think you were as thick as my fridge door. I know.
How is your fridge door? Is it still open?
Well, it's not a good situation. I now believe you to be thicker than the door to the vault at Jodrell Bank.
Do you?
Do you remember in Goldfinger?
Do you remember in Goldfinger? Reference point.
Remember in Goldfinger when they opened the door to the vault at Jodrell Bank?
I don't remember much about Jodrell Bank.
Thicker than your stomach.
Really? Mm. You sure it's not Fort Knox you're thinking of?
It could have been Fort Knox.
Nothing to do with Jodrell Bank.
Hang on, Jodrell Bank's an observatory.
Yeah, it is.
That's right. Yeah, yeah.
I know the door's very thick.
No, I meant Fort Knox.
Fort Knox is where they stole the gold.
That's right, yeah, that's what I meant. Now, excuse me. Now, what I was going to say to you is...
What are you going to say?
Any idiot who thinks that, because Jorge Mendes has said no...
Jorge.
There hasn't been any contact between...
Not Georgie.
You know, Manchester United and... You know what? And Jose, you know what that means? That means there could have been contact between somebody representing Manchester United and somebody representing Jose.
I'm simply reporting to you what the news is saying, and which is that there is nothing on the table.
And I'm simply telling you, you are an oaf of immense proportions
so
if you take that at face value.
So you're maintaining that Mourinho is still going to take over Manchester United?
I believe that if Manchester United are thinking sensibly...
That's not the question I'm asking you.
Well, I can't counter what you've just said. If
Why?
Manchester United don't think sensibly,
right.
they'll lose Jose Mourinho, the best manager in the world.
So you're not actually willing to commit yourself on this one?
I think Pep Guardiola's a bit of a fraud, you know, when you think
about
it.
Well, I mean, he's only managed two clubs, right?
Yes.
Barcelona and Bayern Munich.
Yes.
Where he's been incredibly successful.
Yes.
However, not as successful as Jupp Heynckes, the man who sounds like an aeroplane.
That's right.
That we spoke about last night.
Yeah.
You know, who knows if he comes into a club which is not particularly great at the moment, like Manchester United. I said this months ago.
Pep Guardiola emerged from a brilliant squad of players to player manager to manager of Barcelona. So he never had to bring any players in. He never even had to go and buy anybody.
He did have to get on with the players, I suppose.
He did because he came out of the dressing room. He then moves to Bayern Munich, which are so isolated in their greatness in Germany.
Yeah.
And, of course, probably one of the richest clubs in the world. Because their ability to raise money individually as a club, you know, never mind the TV deals and all that, is enormous. Talk to
also, they're like a giant sinkhole in the Bundesliga. Any decent player that emerges out of the waves just ends up going down it.
But I was talking to my old pal, Alan McAnally. Alan McAnally.
How come he's your old pal?
Well, he's a great pal of mine. I've worked with him in the past.
When did you speak to him?
When did I speak to him? Oh, I saw him at a game quite recently,
did
actually.
You?
Yes, yes. Anyway, the point is, he played for Celtic, but he also played for Bayern Munich.
Yeah.
Now, Alan is so well in with Bayern Munich, München,
yeah.
he can ring the Kaiser on his mobile phone, and did once when I was sitting there having a drink with him.
I hope he didn't ring him while he was being investigated by FIFA.
Well, no.
That could have been a bit embarrassing.
It could have been embarrassing. And Alan says that if you talk to the commercial people at Bayern Munich, because Germany itself is the wealthiest country in Europe, they actually are able to raise billions of pounds in sponsorship from massive corporations based in Germany.
Yeah.
Siemens, Mercedes-Benz.
Allianz.
All these sort of people, you know.
They make fridges, don't
they?
Who? Allianz.
No, the insurance company, idiot.
Oh, okay.
Fridges, that's Bosch.
Siemens, I'm thinking of.
Siemens.
They make fridges.
Siemens make fridges?
Yeah, I'm sure they do, yeah.
Do they?
Yeah.
Okay, well, Bosch do, don't they?
They do.
And
have you got a Bosch fridge?
I've got a Bosch fridge freezer.
Yeah.
I've got a Bosch dishwasher.
Yeah.
And I've got a Bosch. Yeah.
But what about the freezer? Did you tell me it's still not fixed?
I haven't had the heart to address that problem, I'm afraid.
Well, so what's going on with the food in the house then?
Well, I've still got a freezer.
Yeah.
But I can't get the trays in it.
Yeah.
So
it's just a
stuff,
big, like, empty cavern, is it?
No, it's not empty because I wrap the stuff in plastic bags from Tesco's and put them in there.
Yeah, but what I'm saying is there's no shelves. Everything's just piled in at the bottom.
No.
It's like a big pile of food.
No. There are shelves,
but
I can't get the plastic, you know.
Okay. So you've just got stuff in the shelves?
Yes, that's right,
isn't it?
No.
What's wrong with that?
No, because I've got three plastic, what do you call them? Drawers.
Yeah, but you don't need those.
Well, it looks messy.
But it's still working as a freezer, though, is what you're saying.
Oh, yes, yeah. But I'm. Yeah.
Now, what's the ice build-up like?
Severe.
Really?
It's like the Eiger. It's like, honestly, it's worse. It's like Ice Station Zebra
now. Right.
And recovering the food is difficult because a lot of it freezes into the fridge and I have to get it out. I've got a special little Meccano pick. I don't know, I've had it since I was a kid and I use it to chop the ice away and get the food out. But it's, you know, it's not necessary.
It's like living in a cave.
Yeah, well, I mean, you know, I say to myself, normal people don't have to do this.
No,
why am
don't.
I doing this?
Because you're not normal.
Normal
That's
people
the point.
Don't spend 2 hours in car phone warehouse trying to just change their phone from one phone to another to be told, it's no
well,
wonder.
Why did you spend 2 hours in there? Why don't you just ring them up and say, look, I want to exchange my phone. I'm coming
it's
in.
It's just not
and
that
why,
simple.
Why don't they just send you a new
it's
phone?
It's not that simple.
Well, it is that simple. That's
no,
what I do.
Let me tell you, when I got in there, and this kid, by the way, was about 21, a whiz kid, you know, everything that went wrong, he went, ha, 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 ha. I said, could you stop laughing, please?
Right.
He said, what? I said, what are you laughing at?
Yeah.
He said, well, we're trying to move your emails from...
was he reading your emails?
No, he wasn't reading them. He was trying to remove your emails from this phone to your new phone.
Yeah.
I said, yeah, what's the problem? He says, the Vodafone system's gone down. I said, what are you going to do? He said, we'll have to wait for it to come back. I said, how long will that take? He said, it went down the other day. It was 4 hours. I said, it's not good enough. He said,
sure the Vodafone system went down? Because I got Vodafone, the system was fine all day.
Well, I'm telling you, to try and transfer emails, this is exactly what this kid told me. Then the Samsung phone I've got, he looked at it, he said,
why can't he just take the SIM card out of the old phone and put it in the new one?
That's what I said to him. He said, it's not that simple. Oh. I said, why? And then he looked at the phone. He said, oh, he said, have you had a bit of a problem with this phone? I said, yes. I said, it runs out of charge every half hour.
Right.
So I'm not surprising. I said, why? He said, the battery's bent. Look, it's forcing the front of the phone off.
Yeah.
I said, well, you sold me this phone. This is a defective phone. And by the way, exactly the same thing happened a month after I got this phone. And they told me it was a rogue set of batteries and they replaced the battery.
Oh, OK. Now, so you've got another rogue battery.
Another rogue battery. I said, why are you giving me another Samsung? I said, you know, my experience is that these Samsung phones are causing me a problem.
Yeah.
He said, no.
I thought you said you were going to get an iPhone.
Well, I was going to get an iPhone.
Why can't you get one of those?
Because the Vodafone system went down and they can't transfer the emails from one phone to another, right? So, anyway, what about
this? It's like
this?
A disaster zone,
it is
life,
a disaster zone. Anything
I mean, you
electronic?
Think you might be one of these people that has an actual, you know, some kind of disagreement between your bodily functions and electronics.
It wouldn't surprise me, because everything
you know,
I touch electronically...
You know, you've had problems with TVs.
You could be right. Honest to God, you could be right, because everything I touch electronically is going to go wrong. Anyway, so, eventually, old laughing boy, says, you've got to talk to this man on the phone.
Oh, yeah.
Look at this now. I charged this just before we came in.
Yeah.
Connect to a plug socket to charge device and close unused applications.
I hope you've got too many applications open.
I don't open any applications. It's a useless piece of junk at the moment.
Right.
Now then, so laughing boys.
Yeah. Well, as long as you can stop it making that buzzing
sound.
Yeah.
So he dials somebody on the phone and then he says, oh, could you talk to this man? I said, who is this man? He said, he's from
O2. Oh, yeah.
I said, right. No, he didn't, sorry. He said, he's from Vodafone. I said, right, what am I talking to him for? I said, I can't get the system back up. He says, no, we've got to get a pack number to get you off Vodafone onto O2.
Yeah.
I said, what, am I changing networks? He said, we recommend that's best for you.
Yeah.
So he gives me the phone.
Sure, they're not just ripping you off, these people.
They might be. So this guy on the other end, and I realise I'm talking to a man in Northern Ireland, you know, he says, oh, Mr. Parry, how are you today?
That was Brendan Rogers.
Yeah, how are you?
Moonlighting since he's out of work.
How are you today? I said, well, I'm not very well, actually. I've been in this phone shop an hour. I said, I'm trying to get a new phone.
Did you tell him that you'd been in Belfast and had petrol bombs thrown at you?
You've been at Belfast, been down a low fault road and dodged the petrol bombs. Anyway, so he said, so this guy wasn't having it, this guy from Vodafone. I said, so I want, I said, the boy standing next to me said, I've got to ask you for a pack number, please, but you have to tell me personally because I'm the customer. He says, you don't want a pack number. What you want is a new deal. I've got a £36 a month deal. I said, hang on, what are you doing?
How much a month?
£36 a month, all in, no charges. And so I said to Laughing Boy, I said, he's trying to flog me a new package. What's going on? So he snatched the phone and he said, we just want the pack number. He doesn't want your service anymore. Have you got it? Oh, right, OK, yeah. So, I'm with O2 now. I'm with O2.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So you're with O2 now, or you're going to be with O2? Is your phone now with O2?
No, this is another thing. So we've changed over.
Right.
But now Laughing Boy says, ha, 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 ha. He says, at about 4 o'clock tomorrow morning, this phone will go dead. I said, it's permanently dead.
What, morning at 4 o'clock?
No, at 4 o'clock p.m.
Oh, p.m.,
Yeah. He says, this phone will go dead. And your new phone, which I bought, which is a magnificent new Samsung.
Yeah.
It looks great, actually. It's blue. It's metallic, silver blue.
As long as it's blue, that's the most important
thing. Yeah, yeah. And he said, that will spring into life.
And what's the bet it doesn't?
Well, he probably won't, because it's me. So I'm just.
You'll have to go back for another 2 hour session.
Yeah, I think
with
I might have to. I might have to. Isn't it working?
And the bloke from Northern Ireland.
Yeah, no,
what a nightmare.
Honestly, it was just.
I don't know how you put up with it.
I know.
Now, a couple of quick tweets before we go off for a second. Mm. Here's one from Becky. Who says, man gets tie in winners and losers, threatens to club other man to death. Shocking display of sportsmanship. Hashtag Porky crime.
Yes.
Jennifer says, mild weather indeed. He is not sure if it's very high wind, gale force proportions, or angry loud thunder. Dreadful rain, it's torrential. Sean says he can't let Porky and Jimmy Hill win. Dying does not make you a winner.
Is that Jennifer, did you say?
It is Jennifer.
Could that be the Jennifer who sent us a Christmas present?
It is the very same.
Well, Jennifer, thank you very much indeed.
I've eaten some of the chocolates already.
Well, it was a very, very generous gesture.
Have you eaten yours?
Saving mine for Christmas Day.
You're saving them for Christmas
Day? Oh, yes.
Where are they at the moment?
In the fridge, actually.
Are they?
Yes.
Excellent.
Yeah. Fridge works.
The fridge works. I'm glad to hear it.
Below it, yeah.
I'm trying to picture you trying to get your food out of the freezer with an ice pick from Meccano.
It is a bit like that. I'm
plank. This is Talk Sport. Loads more coming up.
Talk Sport.
And it's in!
A diving header at the end of a 50-yard run.
From the root to the tip.
Talk Sport.
This is Talk Sport, we are the two mics. Ask Porky coming up a little bit later on. Winners and losers has been extended, ladies and gentlemen, because it's so close.
Yes.
It was 50-50 at midnight. And so we've extended the voting period until 3 o'clock this afternoon.
Vote Porky, vote often.
We've got lots of tweets to read out, of course.
Okay. What was that record, by the way?
That was Louis.
Oh, Louis?
Yeah.
What's that about?
Well, it's about Louis.
Yeah, well, why are we playing Louis?
Well, I don't know.
Louis Van Gaal, is this?
Well, it could be about Louis Van Gaal.
Yeah, there's much mood on Louis Van Gaal.
We don't have to always have a reason to play a piece of music, do
okay,
we?
Okay, okay. I want to tell you
we're
about...
We're going to talk to Marion Melchiot about Louis Van Gaal.
Yes, that'll be good.
Because he's a former colleague of his.
Yes, and I want to talk to you about the Christmas bladderation situation, because it's critical, okay?
Right. Now, about this from Zobon, who I think is a man who knows you well.
Yes.
He's tweeted, he says, Porky won't eat that chocolate because it's in his car trunk and he's about to give it to someone else for Christmas. Hashtag generous Porky.
That's
to be honest,
harsh.
That is your MO, isn't it?
No, it's not.
You are going to give it to somebody.
Oh, no, I'm not. No. No, I think Jennifer's one of the few people who we can say, you know, absolutely trustworthy, no problem at all.
What, you mean you're not worried about the chocolate being poisoned?
No, I'm not worried about being poisoned. No.
Matt says this, Porky shouldn't win winners and losers because his using Jimmy Hill was a purely tactical move to play on people's sympathy.
No. It was born of respect, believe me. Born of respect.
Stoddard says, also, Mourinho isn't a firefighter. He's one who starts them and leaves the next manager's a massive clean-up job, which is what you're going to suggest is why, which is what I'm going to suggest is why he's not going to get this job.
I'm not sure about that.
Mal says, what's the difference between Porky and his phone? None. Both are useless pieces of junk.
Oh, that's very nice. That's fighting talk.
Very hard.
Who's that from?
That's from somebody called Mal.
Oh, okay, Mal. I got your name written down here in what I call my little black book.
Okay, well, let's hope it works better than your phone.
Yeah.
Dev says, if you took the phone out of your back pocket, maybe the battery wouldn't bend.
No, you idiot, I don't set my blinking phone. It's just the
well,
battery...
I've heard of a battery blending.
Bending?
Bending.
No, but they do. I've shown you, and you agree that the face of the phone is lifting off where the battery's trying to push out of the device.
Now, how about this from Wayne? MG all day long and winners and losers because Porky cheats at everything.
I don't. You're the guy who gerrymanders, not me.
Mm.
By the way, I was delighted to see that old Padre Parry made a visit last night.
Yes.
Sorry I wasn't around.
A lot of people quite enjoyed that. You can go and see it again on Two Mics TV if you wish.
The Christmas Carol. Yeah. Why did you think he had to deliver Christmas Carol, not me?
Well, you were supposed to do it with him, I think, was the plan.
I think I was, actually.
And then you missed out because you weren't able to get here on time. Although, coming in tonight, I have to say, there was hardly any traffic at all.
Well,
I think half the country's already on holiday.
I think you're right. And that's a good thing because it makes the roads easier.
Update on the Two Mics winners and losers. Yeah. It's still 51-49 to you.
Excellent.
1,898 votes cast. Yeah. Could be the biggest ever.
Yeah, could be. Yeah. Mm. Yeah. Vote Porky, vote often.
You've got until 3 o'clock.
Yes, excellent. Right, now then, what I want to tell you about, man, is this situation coming with Christmas. Drink-related admissions in hospitals up 64%.
Okay? Yeah, you see, I saw this report yesterday, and like I always do, I cast my sceptical eye over it, because the problem with these reports and these kind of figures is that they don't just include people who have been taken into A&E because they're so bladderated they don't know what they're doing. Yeah. They put all sorts of things down as drink-related.
Well, they are drink-related. If people fall over and smack their head because they're intoxicated, right?
Yeah, but... I mean, what I'm saying is that people can be brought to hospital from a variety of places, i.e. they're not necessarily out getting drunk.
Yeah.
They might have had an accident at home, they might have fallen down the stairs, and if they've had a drink, it gets put down as a drink-related injury.
Yeah, but the thing is...
It may not be a drink-related injury.
The thing is, to counter that, the people who've drawn up the report say they think it's probably much better. They say that this is a vast underestimation of the true scale of the problem because admissions indirectly linked to drinking, such as falls, domestic violence, heart disease, are not recorded by hospitals as alcohol-related problems.
No, but they are, though. That's the point.
Well, I don't think they are.
Yeah, I think so.
The figure includes patients who spent at least one night in English hospital but exclude emergency patients who were discharged the same day.
Right.
So most people who are taken in with bladderation problems actually only stay there a few hours and then get booted out again because they need the bed.
Okay.
Separate research also published today reports 70% of emergency cases at weekends were linked to drinking at one hospital in the northeast. Well, you know... That's a terrible statistic.
Well, it is that time of the year. I mean, last Friday, I don't know if you were out and about last Friday. I decided not to go out and about last Friday, but apparently that was the biggest drinking day of the year.
Yes.
They call it Black Friday.
Yes, they do,
for a different reason.
In one hospital, drinking is linked to 70% of weekend cases dealt with by a single A&E department, according to research. Alcohol-related attendance at big inner-city hospital over 4 weeks... varied from 4% to 60% on weekends, rising to 70% on Saturday nights. The Newcastle University researchers, writing in the Emergency Medicine Journal, said this indicates a significant NHS burden if all such emergency departments in the UK are suffering similar demands.
Yeah.
And it is an epidemic of drink-related pressure on the National Health Service, and the governments have got to do something about it. But as we don't have any leaders in our government...
You went on about this last night.
As our government is leaderless, as nobody will do anything to make this country the great nation it is...
Why are you banging on about this?
Because we don't have any leaders.
Well, why don't you stand for Parliament if you so worked
out about it? I want a leader.
Well, why don't you stand... Why do you want to be led? You see, the problem with you and people like you is that you want to be led.
I don't want to be led.
I don't want to be led. I don't want a leader. I do my own thing, right?
Yeah.
I live my life the way I wish to live it.
I love my country.
I don't wish to be told what to do.
You don't.
What country is that?
Well, exactly. You don't even know your country.
I'm British, thank you.
And I'm English.
Britain is a country.
And I'm English.
You're Welsh, actually.
I'm not. I'm English. And the point is...
England is not necessarily
a country. Somebody to
so
say...
England does not stand alone as a country.
We will build
England
a third runway.
England does not stand alone as a country.
We will build a third runway.
Why are you ignoring me?
Because you keep parrot-fashioning some
load of
nonsense.
No, I'm saying England... Technically, England's not a country. It's the United Kingdom of Great Britain.
I totally agree.
And
if you hadn't told the Scots that they haven't got a country, you wouldn't get out of Glasgow alive.
I've told them that many times.
In fact, you were very lucky to get out of Glasgow alive the last time we went there. Your behaviour.
I wasn't the one that scurried away early.
Dead right you weren't.
No.
You got immersed in what I would call...
You weren't even there for... How long were you there for? About 10 hours?
I would call the dark arts of Glasgow nightlife.
Well, you've got to do what you're best at.
No, do what you're best at. Yeah. You're best at the dark arts,
I am, very much so.
Right, now what I was going to say is this. When are we going to have somebody who says HS2's a waste of time?
You
16
said all
billion
this yesterday.
Quid. I'm saying it again because
I
want to make the point. And the other thing I want to know is this: when is somebody going to say, actually, when people get bladderated in a city centre, the thing to do is to lock them up in a booze unit until they sober up, right?
They haven't got a booze unit to put them in.
Well, but this is my very point.
Yeah.
They can set up temporary hospital...
Phone going again?
Well, it's...
Why is it buzzing now?
I don't know. Because it's run out of juice altogether.
Why can't you switch it off?
Do you know what?
Why don't you switch it off?
If this phone was a human being and just been dragged out of the sea, it would be unrevivable.
It would be,
It'd be dead.
Yeah.
Honest
to God.
That's
a good idea. Why don't you take it down to Portsmouth at the weekend and chuck it in the
sea? Well, as soon as the other one kicks in and works...
The other one's not going to kick in.
I'm going to dispose of this one painfully.
You've had a terrible time over the years with your phone.
Yeah, I am. Do you know what I'm going to do?
Why don't you just buy a phone, right?
Yeah.
Forget about the deal that you've got with Carphone
Warehouse.
Well,
I didn't know you could do that.
Well, of course you can. You can just go and buy an iPhone.
And then what's...
Go to the Apple store.
So why is that a great benefit?
Well, then you own the phone, right? So you're not leasing it from them.
Yes.
And you don't have to have a contract with them.
Yes.
And you can buy a cheaper contract with some other... You can choose whichever phone company you want.
It's too complicated for me.
It's not.
I've decided I will get an iPhone in the new year just
go
so
to
I
the
can...
Apple store. I'll take it to the Apple store and sort you out.
I'll have a separate phone. I'll have two phones. I'll be called Two Phone Porky.
Two Phones Porky.
Two Phones Porky.
You know what they say about somebody with two phones?
No.
They've got something to hide.
Well, I know that, but I'm not, you know, I don't have to have a secret life because...
Are you sure?
Yeah, my life is an open book.
You're a totally secret life.
My life is an open book.
No, you never put any pictures out of anything you do.
Rubbish.
You never put pictures out of your mates coming around for lunch. You never put pictures out of feeding the ducks.
Oh, when was the last time I saw a picture of you with your mates having lunch?
I don't have lunch with my mates.
No, of course not. Because you haven't got any.
No, I've got plenty, but I don't have lunch with them.
Do you know what I'm going to do with this phone? When my new Samsung kicks in tomorrow, I'm going to do this. I'm going to put it under the front wheel of my new Mercedes, and I'm going to start the car, rev it up and drive over it.
Well, let's hope you don't get a puncture, because you'll get all those things coming up on your... it's made of glass, that, you know. I wouldn't do that for me.
Well, I'll do it on the blind side. I'll do it on the back, which is just metal.
Yeah, but it's metal.
Yeah.
So we'll still get a puncture.
Yeah, but it's flat metal. My tyre's stronger. My rubber tyre's stronger than Samsung metal.
Are you sure?
Yes.
Okay.
I'm going to put it to the test and find out.
Why don't we video it?
Hey?
Which video you have driving over your phone.
All right,
That'd be great.
I'll have that, I'll do that.
Okay.
I so hate this phone, I want it to have a really painful death, all right? In fact, I might get somebody like you to jump up and down it, that would really hurt.
Well, you know, I told you when I first had the mobile phone at the Daily Express, and the photographers, whenever there was a new mobile phone available, they wanted to get rid of their old brick-like phone.
That's right.
And they tried so hard to destroy them, they never could.
Yeah, I know.
One guy actually dropped his off the top of a ship, you know, like about four stories up on some liner, dropped it onto the deck of the ship below, and it still didn't break. One of them tried to run over his phone, it still didn't break.
No, I know.
I mean, they used to throw them at walls.
Amazing.
They were indestructible.
A young lady who was a showbiz reporter I was associated with in those
associated
days.
With?
Yes. I was
in what sense?
Associating with, you know, in the, you know, the sense.
Consorting with?
Yeah,
you had your eye on her, you
this
mean?
Sort of thing.
Is that what
this
you
sort
mean?
Of thing. She...
How'd you get on?
she used to get completely bladderated, and she used to do two things. She used to forget where she'd parked her car before we went out.
Yeah.
And then she'd always leave the mobile phone. She went through about six mobile phones in the days when they cost about £3,000 each, you know what I mean? And just kept leaving them in pubs and things.
Yeah, shocking.
But anyway, that's what used to happen in those days.
Indeed.
But anyway, the phone thing's a nightmare. Just finish it on the drink.
Yeah.
Just finish it on the drink. I was thinking of buying you a Christmas present.
Really?
Which I saw in W.H. Nice Smith today.
Okay.
But I didn't. And it was a
what
brief
was it?
Thought. It was a book of retro cocktail mixes.
Oh, right.
Yes.
Very nice. So well, sort of like a gimlet, that sort of thing.
Well, sort of like the cocktails.
Old-fashioned.
Yeah, that's right. The cocktails we used to mix in the heyday of New York in the 80s and things like that. Oh, you know what I mean?
Well, it's not that old. Not that long ago.
Well, they're quite basic.
The Harvey Wallbanger.
Yeah, that's right. The Harvey Wallbangers and all that kind of stuff. Yeah. But people don't mix them today because they're just too exotic, the ones that they have today. You know what I mean?
Well, they're not really. It's just that certain things are more fashionable than others. There's lots of places in New York, actually, where you can go now and people would drink, you know, lots of whiskey-based cocktails, which is what the older ones were, and gin-based. Cocktails. Now they tend to be tequila-based and vodka-based.
I just can't drink whiskey. I just don't know why. I just can't.
Hmm.
It just makes me feel sick.
Well,
and
a lot of people can't handle it.
Well, I mean, yeah, you say that. You're saying that as though, you know, some sort of, test of manliness.
Well, it is, actually, whiskey. Yeah.
It's not a test of manliness. It's a test of your bladderation genes. And if yours are more developed than mine, then, you know, good luck to you. I couldn't care less.
All right. Here's one from somebody called, let's see, I can't tell.
Good
morning and Merry Christmas, Mr. Graham, Mr. Parry, a.k.a. Talk Sports, the two Rollies. Getting blocked, a.k.a. bladderated, scanning in and out of music stations on the DAB, calling in old friends, and felt I had to wish you both a Merry Christmas. Glad to hear you're on daytime. People don't know what they're missing.
Thank you very much.
And Wayne in Manchester says, between his bent phone, Arctic fridge, and half-finished roof garden, Porky shows that he's that someone people talk about that is always worse off than you. Sounds like a horrendous situation at your house. Right, coming up next, we've got Mario Melchiot to come on. We'll ask him what's going on with Louis van Gaal, see whether he agrees with me that Mourinho's not going to Old Trafford, or whether he agrees with Porky that he definitely is. This is Talk Sport.
This festive season, don't just go big on the tree. Go big on style and space too, with the stunning new Mini Clubman. Equipped with seating for five and enough luggage room to pack in all the trimmings. However big you go this year, book a test drive at your nearest Mini Centre or mini.co.uk/clubman. Test drive is subject to status and availability.
I know. The state pension is changing.
I know. How much you get will still depend on your national insurance record. And don't forget you may still have a private pension to consider too.
I know. I'll be able to see how much I'm likely to receive and understand what I can do to improve my state pension.
I know. If you reach state pension age on or after the 6th of April 2016, you'll be part of the new scheme.
Make sure you know the facts about the new state pension. Visit gov.uk/yourstatepension for more information.
Get a generous helping of the latest odds and tasty tips with Paddy's Punts. Every weekday afternoon from 4 on Drive with Durham and Goffey on Talk Sport with Paddy Power. You're welcome. With the form on the football.
But what a game.
The going on the GGs.
And they're off.
The crack on the cricket.
Six.
And lashings of Paddy's famous generosity.
Ah, come on, gives a break to me a bit of crack, isn't it?
Get your tips while they're hot. With Paddy's Punts. Weekday afternoons from 4 with Adrian Durham and Darren Goff on Talk Sport with Paddy Power. You're welcome.
Christmas 2015 on Talk Sport. Turkey, tinsel, terraces, and the waft of supermarket own brand aftershave. Merry Christmas. Talk Sport.
Millions of people living as ho-ho-ho's.
This is Talk Sport. We are the two mics. There is an Ask Porky coming up. Winners and losers voting still going on, of course, until 3 a.m. So you can still do that. Lots of people got lots to say about Jose Mourinho and about the Everton possible takeover as well. We're going to talk now to Mario Melchiot, former player at Chelsea and, of course, played under Louis van Gaal at Ajax in the 1990s. Mario, delightful to have you on. Thanks for joining us.
Yeah, good being here, guys.
Now, you've probably been following the situation with Louis van Gaal at Manchester United. There's talk on the back pages this morning of crisis talks of Wayne Rooney trying to get all the players together to save the season. Do you think he's going to stay or do you think he's going to go before the end of the season?
I mean, everybody knows. If you become a coach at Man United, pressure is always going to be on you if you don't perform. I know him really well, you understand, because he's the guy that gave me my famous debut for Ajax and for the national team of Holland. But away from that, he has his way of working, and I know that some people are jumping on it and are not so happy with it, but some people are really performing really well under him. So the thing is really simple. You spend a lot of money, you understand, because everybody knows he spent a lot of money to get this team going, and then they're not scoring. So people are going to point fingers at you, especially if you take over from... they're still in the era of Ferguson. And right. Guys, what he has done is almost impossible to achieve. So that's why you always going to be second best, and especially when it comes to that your team is not scoring, but you're still up there trying to win the title.
Mario, whatever the position is, don't you think it'd be wise for Manchester United to do something? Because there is now a period of great uncertainty. You know, the headlines in some of the papers, LVG on brink after high-level meeting, board dilemma as Jose and Pep wait. Then other headlines saying that Wayne Rooney's going around calling meetings of the players and telling them to rally behind the boss. And I mean, this is so much uncertainty and there's such nervousness around Manchester United. If I was in charge of Manchester United, I would sack Louis van Gaal because of the, you know, the unknowingness of what's going to happen. I would sack him. I'd ring up Jose Mourinho. I'd say, Jose, come here, please. It's at least 10 million a year that you were getting at Chelsea. Make us a great club again.
Yeah, I know. I totally understand because everybody wants to see Man United back on the top. You understand? Regardless of what kind of relationship you have with the manager that's in charge right now. And I agree. But you know what the problem is now? We are right in front of, you understand, the window to go back open. So Man United has to make a decision. Mm. If they keep him on, they probably have to give him money to add players to the team. If you don't keep him on, you want to give the possibility for the new manager that comes in to have the possibility and enough time to bring in what he wants to bring in.
Yeah.
Because, guys, you have to remember, when it opens up now, you don't have a lot of time because you got to move fast. That window opens, you got to make it. You got to make some kind of movement. And yeah. I totally agree. The board has to make a decision. You either tell the manager we're going to keep you on, or you tell them we're not going to keep you on. The longer you prolong it, the more unstable the fans are going to be. I mean, they booed the manager off in the last game, Van Gaal. He had some problems. You don't want that at your stadium. You don't want uncertainty to create even more of it. So they have to make a decision. And regardless of what we feel or what we think is right, the board needs to make a decision because that's exactly what Chelsea did. They made their decision right before the window is going to open. So they timed it perfectly because they know the one that's going to come in, we need to give him the space to make sure that he can put this team back on track because there is no time. Chelsea's right at the bottom. Man United is right at the top. We're talking about two managers, you know, Mourinho leaving Chelsea, going back to Man United. Guys, take Mourinho from Chelsea back into Man United. It's too early for him to go straight into a team. He individually, probably he will say, if he gets the opportunity, he will say, no, I'm ready for it. Mm-hmm. But do you really want that? That's also a question, guys, because it's a sensitive thing. You take a guy from Chelsea that he was struggling at Chelsea to get his team going. Doesn't mean he can't perform at Man United, but still you will be like, why would you want to take somebody already from making that move? Maybe you want to go elsewhere and see like, hey, get somebody fresh in. But hey, if the opportunity comes, I will doubt that Mourinho will say no.
Yeah, I think you're right, because I don't see it happening. I mean, Jorge Mendes has come out tonight and said that there's no conversation, there's no deal on the table.
Yeah, but he would say that, wouldn't he?
Yeah, but you see, Mourinho...
Yeah, but he would say that. Yeah, he would, yeah.
But also, Mario, Mourinho has never taken over a team in mid-season. You know, he likes to go in and get some assurances that he's going to be able to bring the players in that he wants and all of that. I just don't think anything's going to happen here. I think Louis van Gaal is going to be there till the end of the season. So I don't think the board at Manchester United, who have allowed him to spend 250 million quid of their money and apparently not buy anybody decent or anybody that works, you know, I don't think they know what they're doing.
Yeah, but you know what the problem is with Man United too? When Van Gaal came in, he had all that money, guys. Mm-hmm. But he had only, the only thing that he could give that player was Man United. He couldn't give him the Champions League at that point. So that's also a problem, man. Because you can have all that value and all that capital to throw at a player, but most of the top players want to play the Champions League. Come on, guys. That's where the creme de la creme is. That's where you play against the best. That's where you get the best exposure away from the Premier League, because the Premier League will always be the number one exposure league in the world. But away from that, in Europe, you want to play against the likes of Messi, Ronaldo, you know, Paris Saint-Germain is one of those teams, you know, where the top players are. Mm. And if you go to a team like Man United that's always been part of the Champions League and they're not, you can have a lot of money, but some of the players will think twice, regardless if it's Man United, guys. We're talking about Man United here. We're not talking about some low team.
Yep.
But still, you make a decision and say to yourself, do I want to go to Man United and don't play Premier League, but have a great salary, or will I go somewhere else and then see what I can achieve there? Look at De Maria. He moved on. Where did he move on to? He moved on to a Champions League team. Mm-hmm. Okay, probably now, you understand, because he knows that there is something that can happen. And he had that move already on, you know, on the radar, but he chose Man United because Louis van Gaal probably put the proposal really nice to him. But now he said, hey, I got to make my move because this team is probably not the team that I thought I could perform really well at.
No, exactly right. Now, you've played under him and you say you know Louis van Gaal very well. What sort of a guy is he in terms of how he's going to now react to what's going on around him? Is he a bit like Mourinho where he goes into a kind of a shell and he becomes like a bunker mentality? Or how does he fight his way out of this, do you think?
Yeah, look, those are two guys. They're very confident and they know each other really well. So they have similarities, you know, Mourinho and van Gaal, because I speak to both. I mean, when we meet, we talk. But they are similar, you know. They have their own way of working. You either like it or you don't. I think that the two difference between van Gaal and Mourinho is like when you're young, you meet both of them and you kind of play the game the way they want it. It helps you really well as a young, you know, a young talent. They can really scope you. But when you're an older player, sometimes you can get that little friction because you might not be able to do certain things that you would do when you're not playing. Like if you're 19 or 20 and someone tells you something, you most likely do it straight away because you're just eager to learn. But when you're an older and you're already seasoned player, it's sometimes very difficult because van Gaal is really set in his ways. You understand? It helped me a lot in my career, but I don't know if everybody can do that later in his career. Like when you're 28, 27, you know, on time and all this and do perfectly that. And it's like, you know, it's so strict.
Yeah.
And sometimes that can cause friction, especially in England when you have always that freedom in England. It's only in England where people only care about in England is what do you do on the field. Outside, they don't really care what you do.
Yeah, but Mario, I think the answer to my colleague's question came in the form of the body language of Louis van Gaal after the defeat to Norwich. The man was slumped in his seat. He never got off his seat. He never went to the technical area. At the end of the game, his shoulders were hunched. His head was down. Ryan Giggs wasn't talking to him, his assistant, because he was so upset. And afterwards, he talked about his own future. That guy's finished. He can't possibly lead from the front now. He's finished because he's lost all his own self-confidence. He can't lead a team of men now. Manchester United are off their rocker if they allow him to be the manager of their team for one more day. He's got to go. That's the only way Manchester United can rescue their season and rescue the declining powers of their club.
I agree. So that to rescue their season, they have to make a change. But then the question comes, who are you going to bring in? Because if you bring in somebody...
Jose Mourinho,
sure
of course.
Somebody's going to be... Yeah, because if you bring Mourinho in, guys, are you? Because you have to remember, okay, ask you this question. How do you want Man United to play? You want to play...
Doesn't matter how they play. Doesn't matter how they play, as long as they win. As long as they start winning.
Yeah,
again.
But that's not what the fans say. You want attacking football, right?
I don't agree. The fans want to win.
No, the fans don't want to win. I mean, they're in the top. I mean, Man United have been in the top four most of the season, right? They've now dropped out of the top four one place to fifth.
Yeah.
And the fans are booing them.
Yeah.
They're having quite a successful season.
No, well, they're not really, considering they've lost their last three games.
But they're fifth, though.
That's a contradictory statement. They've lost their last three games, and the fans want them to win.
Very early in the season.
The fans don't want LVG.
Yeah, but, okay, guys, listen, let's go back to what we're saying now. Okay, he lost three games on the spin. Okay, that's bad, because we're talking about Man United. Big team. Mm. They should not have that. Maybe one lose. You can lose one time, but then you got to win five. That's a good ratio for a team like Man United. Okay, but then we look back at how Man United is playing. What is the secret of Man United when Ferguson was there? They're always in control of the game. They pass the ball around. They make the team tired. Counterattacks. Beautiful football. Mourinho is somebody that likes to sit back and hit you on the break.
Mm-hmm.
Nowadays, what happened at Chelsea, it became predictable.
Mm-hmm.
That was his biggest downside. He became too predictable, and he didn't have the players to achieve what he did in the first term. In the first term, he had the likes of Robin, Duff, Joe Cole. He had a striker like Didier Drogba that would score goals, and the wingers were quick enough and could hit him on the break. Mm. This time around, he only had Costa. Costa was focusing more on how he could bully a defender. His focus was not even on the game sometimes. Then he has a left winger, and Eden Hazard. So much pressure is on that kid that the performance for him was very difficult. And on the right side, they've been struggling to find a winger that could score goals and produce. They had William there for a long time. Then they bought Pedro. It still didn't work. So what he had no balance in his attacking force because it will be all the pressure on Hazard. You double up on that side. And then you have Costa, you get him a red card or a yellow card, and he's out. And then the right wing is not always productive. William, when he tucked into the middle, I thought he performed way better. And especially with his delivery with the free kick, that's where he really became the player that Chelsea needed. Mm-hmm. But guys, this is what you're going to get. If you want him to Man United, you're going to get similarities.
Yes, no, of course.
It doesn't mean that he's not a top coach, but you will not get the games that you guys are asking for. Everybody in England is complaining about the style they want Man United to play. It's the beautiful game. The beautiful game, you understand, is not the Mourinho is pure business. If you want business and trophies, you get Mourinho. If you want a beautiful game, it might not be the right guy for you.
Yeah, and Louis van Gaal might not be the right guy for either of those things. If you were in charge at Man United now, Mario, would you fire Louis van Gaal now?
After that money I spent? I can't do that. You know why I'm saying that, why I can't fire him? Because
why?
I gave him too much money, you understand? I think I'm now too late.
Okay.
They had to fire him last week, so they give him more time, you understand, to the next guy coming in. And because they didn't do that, they're going to wait longer because they had this meeting and they still didn't have the meeting about the coach. They said they had the meeting about merchandising.
They're still doing it. Mario, listen, we've got to go. We're out of time. Thank you very much indeed for joining us. Mario Melchiot there.
Should have fired
him. He agrees with me.
I don't care if he agrees with you.
What do you mean don't care? Mario Melchiot, very respected man, Fox pundit in America, former Chelsea player, knows Mourinho, played under Louis van Gaal at Ajax, and you're dismissing his opinion.
Anybody who doesn't realise Manchester United have to act. They're not acting, and the acting means gross uncertainty.
They won't act.
Well, if they don't act, then they're fools, and anybody who doesn't accept that is a complete
Mourinho
dimwit.
Mourinho is not going to Manchester United.
Complete dimwit.
It's not happening. There's plenty of dimwits around here.
No, the dimwits don't understand. Look, you have to be a person of action. If you're not winning, it's because you're not trying hard enough.
You're not giving me any answers here. You're just pontificating about which you have no control.
Let me tell you this.
You're saying to me that Van Gaal is going to go and Mourinho's going to get the job. I don't see that happening.
Well, that's what Manchester United should be doing.
That's what things should be happening, but it's not happening.
When you are inert, when you are inactive, when you are feeble and unable to make a decision and do the right thing, what you do is produce a vacuum.
Yeah.
And within that vacuum,
that's how they got to where they are now.
Chaos and decay starts to set in. And that's what's happening.
Sounds like your fridge, freezer.
That's what's happening at Old Trafford.
Yeah.
That is obvious to me. It's obvious to anybody who is a right-thinking person.
Time, by the way.
Anybody who doesn't agree with me is a dimwit.
Yeah, well, that's what you normally say. Of course, you can still vote for winners and losers. Porky thinks anyone who doesn't agree with him is a dimwit. So I think you should react to that in some way.
On DAB Digital Radio and 1089 and 1053 AM.
A terrific performance.
Turn of pace and eye for goal.
Shout about it.
Talk Sport.
This is Talk Sport. We are the two mics. There will, of course, be a podcast coming out a little bit later on this morning. I've got loads of tweets and texts to read out.
Yes.
Do you mind if I do a couple of those? Here's one from Graham.
Are you all right with the hair? I've spent the break combing my hair.
Oh, yeah, I saw you combing your hair out there. Actually, no, it's because it's all sprung up again.
No.
It has. It's all sprung up at the front.
No. It's because
I'm going to take a picture of it, actually, and send it out because it's literally sprung up. Like, you've got about, I can probably count on one hand, the number of pieces of hair that come out of your forehead.
Don't be
ridiculous.
There's
about five of them, right?
They're all
pointing straight up.
I've got spring-loaded headphones, and that's...
Spring-loaded? Have you brought the faux leather pouch tonight?
That bouffants my hair.
Let me read some of these out to you.
Okay, go on.
So, says Graham in Bath, not only does Porky boil his vegetables, he boils his own skin as well.
Well, no. I give it hot shower treatment to get the grime out of the inner pores.
How dirty do you get, for heaven's sake?
Well, you know, life is a dirty business.
It can be. Mm. Sam in Redhill says, £50 million initial investment into Crystal Palace for stadium improvement only. Main stand to start with, more to follow in time.
Mm.
Here's one, from Zach in Plymouth. So MG can't eat biscuits in the studio, but it's fine for Porky to let his phone constantly ring.
Well,
#PorkyStandards.
It had to be powered up because it ran out of juice. I mean, it's the most disastrous phone in the world.
Right.
And by the way, I'm not... I'm not branding the brand as being bad because I've taken up a new one.
Yeah, but you keep doing the same thing.
Yeah.
I mean, you know, the definition of insanity
is
to continue to do the same thing and expect a different outcome.
No, but what I'm saying
is... Every phone you've ever had goes wrong.
The guy's admitted it had a bent battery.
Yeah, but every phone, you've got something wrong with it.
It's true.
This is from Kenny B. He says, what a numpty Mike Parry is. He can't defrost a fridge, can't work a mobile phone.
Yeah.
What a useless individual. #technoplank.
I think that is very, very harsh. Listen, I'm going to show you...
Roger says, why don't you... You should let the phone
Who's
boy.
That? Roger.
Roger says,
oh, yeah, Roger.
Let the phone boy fix his fridge.
Yeah. Well, you know, Laughing Roger. Boy. Can I say this? If I had a name like yours, Roger, you know, I wouldn't.
There's nothing wrong with Roger.
I wouldn't. Well, if you saw the Pastor Parry's Christmas
Parry.
Carol last
yeah.
night, Padre Parry.
Yeah.
Word Roger comes into that.
It does quite a bit. Well, you go have a look at it. How about this from Ben?
Yes.
Do texts ever get read out on this station? He says. He's texted in.
Does what?
He says, do texts ever get read out
yes,
on this station?
Just read yours
out. Just read yours out, Ben.
Now, I'm showing you the page three of a popular tabloid newspaper
Indeed.
For tomorrow morning.
Yes.
There's a picture of a very pretty lady.
Yeah.
Does she remind you of anybody we might have met recently in Glasgow?
What, that woman there?
Yes.
Not particularly, no.
Oh, really?
No. What are you thinking of?
Oh, you know, just, you know, one or two people who joined us in the dressing room afterwards, you know.
Who are you thinking of specifically?
Well, I mean, I can't, you know, start mentioning names, can I?
Alioha. Aliona.
Mm.
Who is she?
Well, I don't know. I think she's in, hang on, Strictly Champion. She's a champion of Strictly
Come
Dancing.
I don't know what you're talking about.
Look at her face. Doesn't it remind you of the image of somebody else that we know?
No.
It doesn't?
Not
okay.
really.
All right, fair enough.
Well, who are you thinking of?
Well, you know, it's not... I'm
I mean,
not
she's very blonde, quite striking.
Mm-hmm, yeah. Tallish girl, yeah.
Yeah?
Yeah, yeah.
Well, who are you thinking of?
No, I'm not thinking of anybody. You know,
I don't remember anybody in Glasgow looking like that.
Oh, OK. Well, that's all right, that's fine. Now,
I'm puzzled now as to why you would say that.
Well, all I said is, does it remind you of it? You said no, so
doesn't.
I'm not going to say to you...
Well, who does it remind you of?
Well, you know...
I mean, it doesn't remind me of Bob Smith, who was there.
No,
it doesn't remind me of my ex-producer from Talk 107.
No, that's true. That's
who, true. Who are you talking about?
Well, I'd rather move on, because if it doesn't prompt a memory for you, then there's no point in talking about
no,
it.
No, OK.
I want to show you a picture of another woman who's extremely good-looking, and her name, of course, is... Wife of Jensen. That's an interesting name. Jessica.
Wife of Jensen.
Yeah.
Good evening, Wife of Jensen. How are you?
Yeah.
Or soon to be ex-wife of Jensen.
Well, this is the point. Jessica Michibata, who's 31.
Yeah. Michibata.
Married Jensen Button earlier this year in Hawaii.
Yeah.
Apparently, they haven't lived together ever since.
Right.
And
that's a recipe for disaster.
According to a report in this morning's newspapers.
Yeah.
They are now preparing some kind of separation, which means there'll be discussion over his £35 million fortune.
Well, so she won't get half of that, will she?
Well, I don't know. I've no idea.
Half of that's not a bad year's pay, is it?
Very attractive lady.
Yeah.
And it says the
I don't recognise her from Glasgow either.
According to this claim, the pair never lived together and there will now be a divorce discussion over the £35 million fortune.
Well, that's a shame, isn't it?
Love split couple Jensen Button and Jessica Michibata never lived together after tying the knot.
Yeah. It's
an odd arrangement, though, isn't it? Why
I suppose he travels a lot, doesn't he? And she probably works...
Oh, she's an international model based mostly in Tokyo, apparently.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Yeah, so he only goes to Japan for the Japanese Grand Prix.
I suppose so.
And she's probably flying around the world at different times to him. It's a bit like with some of these tennis players, you know.
Yeah.
Well, do you remember Rory McIlroy?
Rory McIlroy.
When he was with Caroline Wozniacki.
Yes,
had to make special arrangements to actually go and watch her play tennis because he was usually in a different part of the world.
That's right.
And in fact, there were some who said that he sort of flunked out of the Dubai Classic so that he could go and watch her playing in the Australian Open.
That's right.
And that didn't work terribly well.
And I think I've read somewhere that he might now be preparing the nuptials with his new girlfriend.
With his new girlfriend who works for the US PGA, I think, doesn't she?
She does, yeah. She does.
Interesting
times. Yes.
Here's one from Lord Aralo. He says, hey, Porkmeister, I'm an American and I have no idea what Boxing Day is. Please explain.
Boxing Day?
Yeah.
Well, you know what Boxing Day is. Boxing Day is the day after Christmas Day. It's the 26th of December.
It is.
So called because in Georgian times...
Oh, look, some mince pies.
What's going on here?
See, mince pies at this time of the year are permissible.
Come on, come
they
on,
They are permissible
fellas.
In the studio.
Come on, where's the professionalism in this
Well, we'll
in
eat
this
them
show.
While we're on the air. We'll eat them,
well,
you know.
You're rattling biscuit boxes.
He's making a bit more noise than necessary, that's
mince
true.
Mince pies?
Do you
I'm
not
want
a mince
I'm
pie?
Not, no, I do not want a mince pie, thank you.
Have you had one this year yet?
No, I've not had a mince pie this year, and I certainly haven't had one in the middle of a live broadcast. I think you're a disgrace.
Well, it's Christmas.
I think
we're 2 days away
I think
from
you're
Christmas.
Disgrace. Where's our producer?
He's got the biscuits.
Oh, he's eating the biscuits and bringing them in.
Oh, look, they're all gone.
Blinking.
These
disgrace.
Are really nice, actually. You should really try them. Look at that. This is fantastic.
So you've just ripped the
three more chocolate
the silver foil now for the next level of biscuit. It's a disgrace. Take them away, please. I'm not having anything to do with
it. It's just a bar humbug attitude to everybody, don't you?
No, I think...
I mean, do you not feel as though at this time of year you should be being slightly more generous of spirit?
No, I don't.
Being slightly less kind of draconian about some of the things that you'd say everybody should do?
That's why we lost the British Empire.
No, it's not.
Our standards slipped at critical times.
No, it's not. We lost the British Empire. Absolute rubbish.
Our standards
slipped. We lost the British Empire because time marched on.
Other people took advantage of us when we looked the other way.
No, people were no longer able for us to take advantage of them because they became educated, they became a little bit more wise, and they became a little bit more independent.
I don't think we did take advantage of people. I think that in many parts of the world, There was a great mutual benefit in introducing new thoughts, new ideas, new technology.
Yeah, there was.
And
but after a while,
local people in developing countries managing to embrace
that.
Yes,
of course. But after a while, that particular advantage that we had, if you like, in terms of introducing technology and introducing different ways of working and living and all that, that became passé. And basically the people who were in those countries decided we should be able to run our own shop. So let's do that instead.
Okay.
I don't think there's anything wrong with that.
And how is the former Rhodesia doing today?
Zimbabwe?
Yes.
Not very well.
Exactly.
How's India doing?
Extremely well.
Thank you.
They're a very good
country. I think India, by far and away, outweighs anything that's going wrong in some of the African countries.
When I was in Pakistan a few years ago, right, which, of course, used to be part of India until partition, until the end of the British Empire.
1947.
And all that. I used to talk to people there. That's right, 1947, yeah. I used to talk to people there, and they used to say, we can never thank the British enough for the values they brought us, right?
Oh, yeah. Like, who were these people in the British Embassy you were talking to?
No. These are people who were sort of Indian businessmen.
Businessmen?
Yeah, and all this kind
of stuff.
In Pakistan? Yeah. It's a thriving country. And,
what were Indian businessmen doing in Pakistan?
Sorry?
What were Indian businessmen doing in Pakistan?
No, they were Pakistan businessmen in Pakistan.
Right.
I'm saying it used to be part of India before it was partitioned.
1947.
Right? Exactly, yeah. And they said, you know...
There's that number again. 47.
We will always be grateful for what the British were. The British were, the justice system, a code of business practice. Mm. They built roads.
Yeah.
They built railways. Yeah. Seriously. And they said, I remember one of them saying to me, it was amazing. He said, my father remembers when the British were, first here.
Yeah.
And the British Empire was at its height.
Yeah.
He said, and the thing that they always used to say was the British insisted on the roads being cleaned each day.
Yeah.
And therefore set the standards for the way people behaved and all that kind of stuff.
Really?
Interesting, really. It's the old broken window system, isn't it?
No,
you know what I mean?
No.
Yes, it is. It is.
What were the streets like in Pakistan when you were there? Clean?
I can't remember, actually.
Can't remember the streets.
One of the reasons I can't remember is I went back there with Benazir Bhutto.
Yeah.
And as we got off the plane, there were a million people outside the airport to welcome him back as the new leader.
A million?
A million.
Did you not think they were there for you?
No, I
Did
wasn't,
that not cross your mind?
No.
You weren't quite such an egomaniac in those days.
Well, I'm not an egomaniac now.
Well, this must be years ago you're talking about.
Oh, yeah, I am,
Benazir Bhutto.
Yeah.
You said a few years ago.
Yeah, a few years ago.
You're talking decades.
Yeah, a couple of decades, definitely.
Couple of decades?
Yeah, yeah.
And when you tell these stories and you go, oh, yeah, a few years ago, why don't you just say 20 years ago?
Well, because I can't remember exactly when it was. But anyway, the point of the story is...
But it's not a few years ago, is it?
We got on the back of a flower lorry.
Yeah.
Have you ever been on a flower lorry?
What, you mean a flower lorry with flowers from Amsterdam type flowers?
No.
Or do you mean flour as in baking flour?
Oh, no. What I mean is a lorry completely decked out in real flowers.
Oh, right, like garlands.
Amazing. Yeah, garlands.
I can't say I've
Yeah, I have, yeah, and I travelled in one of those. It took like
Must
2 hours.
Must have been very fragrant.
To get from the airport to the centre of, I can't remember which town.
Islamabad?
No, it wasn't
Lahore.
Lahore, it was Lahore. Yeah. That's Benazir Bhutto's HQ.
Yeah.
7 miles from the airport to the centre of town.
Yeah.
Well, the Sheraton, where I was staying. And it took 2 hours.
Yeah.
Because the traffic was high. And when we got to the Sheraton, by the way, the amazing thing was the only drink on...
the time, by the
way. Yeah, don't worry about time for a minute. The only drink on sale...
Yeah.
Was Newcastle Brown, believe it or not.
Really?
Yeah, the only alcoholic drink on sale was Newcastle Brown because it's...
In bottles.
In bottles, that's right, it's dry country. However, they had quite an extensive bar, but the only beer was Newcastle Brown.
Yeah.
And I'll just finish the story because what happened was, if you signed a pledge that you were a non-Muslim, you were allowed 2 bottles of Newcastle Brown a day. Because you're a Christian.
Well, that wouldn't have lasted you long, would it?
No, it didn't. So there were all these very pretty air hostesses in the same hotel from British Airways.
Yeah.
And so with rat-like cunning, I went round the bar of the hotel that evening when we'd, been working all night and all day and all this kind of stuff.
Yeah.
And asked every sort of Western person, hello, how are you? How are you doing?
Can I have your 2 bottles
yes,
of ration?
Yes.
That's embarrassing.
Yes, can you sign this pledge,
That's
please?
Shocking.
Can you sign this pledge for me?
Yeah.
And I explained that I was doing a research project for the Daily Express, of which I was a reporter,
Such a
top
liar.
Reporter.
It's
so,
awful.
Yeah, so anyway...
So how many bottles did you snare off them, then?
20. I've got 10 pledges, from sort of Western businessmen and glamorous sort of actress-type women and all this kind of stuff, saying it was an experiment.
Yeah.
When I got the 20 bottles, then we invited all the air hostesses from British Airways to our room, because I had a suite, obviously.
Yeah, of course.
And we had a fantastic party.
Nuki Brown knees up.
Yeah, it was. Yeah, it was. That's all you could
Shocking.
Drink was Newcastle Brown. But
That's
it,
horrible.
It was brilliant.
A horrible story.
And the shock that the cleaning people had the next day was awful because they'd never seen the remains or the aftermath of a drunken Western style party.
Yeah.
It could have been disgraceful if I hadn't sort of you know, sorted things out.
Yes, of course.
With a bit of a bribe. I bribed everybody. Shocking.
Look at the state of the time,
yeah,
by the way.
Yeah. By the way, it's easy to bribe people in Pakistan.
Yeah, I know.
A lot of people aren't that wealthy, so if you give them $5, no problem.
Right. Mm. Stop talking.
Yeah, OK.
This is Talk Sport.
The best ever DFS winter sale is now on, with savings on every sofa in store. You can choose the exact style, fabric and colour that best suits your home. And because every sofa is handmade to order and comes with a 10-year guarantee, you know your sofa will be at its best for years to come. Which sofa will you fall for in the best ever DFS winter sale? Doors open 9 a.m. Boxing Day. Not present APR representative.
The big red building on Golders Green Road.
The big pre-Christmas sale is now on at the big red building in Golders Green Road. Beautifully tailored men's suits from only $79.95. Plus big reductions on dinner suits, cashmere and wool overcoats, jackets and trousers. At Gold's Factory Outlet, 110 to 114 Golders Green Road. Open all week Sunday to Thursday 10 to 6, half day Friday, close Saturday. Open Christmas Day, Boxing Day and Bank Holiday.
The big red building on Golders Green Road.
You fancy a flutter on the football, a gamble on the golf, a double on the darts, or a treble on the tennis? You're in luck. Get closer to the action every weekend with Betway's Man in the Know on the Weekend Sports Breakfast with Georgie Bingham and Mickey Quinn. Bringing you all the form on the football, the going at Goodwood, the tries at Twickenham, and the overs at the Oval. Every Saturday and Sunday morning from 7 on TalkSport with Betway. Bet now at betway.com.
On DAB Digital Radio and 1089 and 1053 AM.
The pressure's on now.
Relieve the itch. Talk Sport.
This is Talk Sport. We are the two mics. Ask Porky coming up in a little while. We've only got about 40 minutes left or thereabouts to vote in winners and losers. Still 52 to 48 to you at the moment.
Vote Porky, vote often. Mm. Yes, that's my cry.
Amazing number of votes. Nearly 2,000 votes have come in.
Yeah, well, that's excellent. We like that.
Now, how about this before you say anything else? Janice has texted in.
Janice.
To 81089.
Lovely name.
In Salford. And she says this.
Salford, great place. We've performed there.
We have indeed. At the Lowry.
Lowry Theatre.
Hey, Pinky and Perky, she says. Which one do you think she thinks is Pinky and which one is Perky? Anyway, did you two former super sleuths of the tabloid press know that on Monday just gone, it was the 102nd anniversary of the crossword puzzle, which I believe first appeared in the New York Times in 1913 and was devised by the editor, who I think was called Alfred somebody?
Yeah, I did know that, actually.
Did you?
Yeah.
And why did you mention it then?
I didn't think it was relevant, to be honest, because...
Well, because I mean, we do anniversaries of all sorts of other nonsense.
Well, we do, but can I just say this, that I have never filled in a crossword puzzle in my life.
Really?
The most boring individual in the world you can find is somebody who says, oh, I can do the Times crossword in 7 minutes.
My father used to do the Times crossword.
I'm sure he would. Your father was a very intelligent man, you know, when he was a sort of normal sort of bloke. And
that's very cut to the nicest thing you've ever said about him.
Yeah, exactly. No, what I was going to say was, you know what? I sometimes get on a train or something, or I sometimes am in a coffee bar or something like that. And if I see people folding the paper in half and starting the crossword, you know, the mini crossword on the back of the paper, I think, you louse, you know, what a wastrel you are. You've got nothing better to do with your life than sit there and fill in a crossword puzzle.
But it's an activity for your mind. It's been well proven, actually, that older people, if they take up those kinds of activities, are less likely to develop dementia. Although it didn't work for my old man, obviously. But, you know, they say that if you keep your mind active while you're aging, then it's better for your brain.
At 9 o'clock in the morning, you should be actively planning your day. You should be getting on with the problems in life, answering the emails.
Well, yeah, but you don't have to spend all returning, day practicing for what you're going to do later.
Yeah, but you do have to start the day like that, returning phone calls.
Well, not everybody's like you. Not
getting
on
to people
and
giving them hassle if they're not doing what they should be doing.
But I mean, you waste half your life because you've got so much going wrong in your life.
Your phone
doesn't work, your fridge freezer doesn't work,
well, that's true.
You know, your washing machine breaks down.
It does.
You know, you've got to worry about people dumping things outside your door. You've got to worry about getting a new car delivered.
Ceilings falling in.
You know, rain coming down into
a
hole in the roof.
That's right.
You know, the problem with you is that you've got so much going on that you haven't got any time to exercise your brain. And actually what you should do is take some time out when you're on the train, perhaps, and do a bit of a crossword or a bit of Sudoku. You never done Sudoku?
No.
Why not?
My sister does it, and I think it's pathetic.
It's not.
Pathetic. Oh, add up numbers on this line, add up numbers on that line.
No, you don't add them up.
Oh, ridiculous.
No, it's quite a challenge, actually.
Anyway.
There was a period of time when I was quite into Sudoku.
Rubbish.
And I once went on a transatlantic flight, and I bought a book.
What a Sudoku book.
What do you mean a saddo?
Blinking saddo.
And I sat there and I did all of them until I got to the point where it was too hard, and I actually gave up.
Yeah, well, that's typical of you. Anything gets hard, you give up. Marriage. Bringing up children.
Marriage wasn't hard.
You know, working as a responsible...
Bringing up children's not difficult.
Working as a responsible executive in newspapers.
Not true.
No, all too hard. So you take to drink and you blow everything up.
That's not true.
Anyway, let's not...
That's a disgraceful thing to say.
No, it's not.
A terrible allegation.
It's absolutely accurate.
Well, how about this about you then? Mm. James says, oh God, he's off on one again, all over mince pies and biscuits. Mm. What a Scrooge Porky is.
No, why? I think it's disgraceful. Scrooge. It's disgraceful that you should start eating. It's disrespectful to our audience.
It's not at all disrespectful.
The millions of people listening to us expect
there are clear, people listening and eating.
Queer.
What?
Queer. Then. Clear, elucidatory diction, OK?
Yeah.
Clear, elucidatory diction.
Well, they're getting plenty of that from
and
me.
And you don't get that if your mouth's half
they're
full
getting plenty of, that
of
from
a mince
me.
Pie. So
plenty,
I don't like it.
Plenty of that from me.
And I'm
me.
Not having it. I might even report you to the management, actually.
Yeah, well, now, that would sort of thing you would do.
Now then.
Flipe.
Now, you just talked about an anniversary, about the crossword. I want to tell you about another...
Well, that was Janice's anniversary.
Yeah, I know. A very distinguished anniversary, OK? And,
yeah, go
on. And I say this with a bit of reverence,
yeah.
But today is, in fact, the 64th birthday
yeah.
of the chairman of the Board of Governors of my former school, Chester King School, Chester.
So what?
And it is...
So what?
No, but you know who it is.
Who?
It is the Duke of Westminster.
Oh, God.
Who is Britain's...
He's such a creep.
No, hang on. He's Britain's richest...
It's going to be your birthday soon, isn't it?
He's
your birthday soon?
We're not talking about mine. We're talking about the Duke of Westminster's. Britain's richest landlord.
So what?
How about that? Richard,
I couldn't care
landowner,
less about
actually.
The Duke of Westminster.
Britain's richest landowner. He's got
well, what's
about
he gonna
7
do?
Billion.
Well, what's he going to do for his amazing well, anniversary stroke birthday?
Can I tell you something which I haven't told you before?
Well, I'll be amazed about that. Go on.
I went to his 21st birthday party.
And how old were you then?
16-ish.
You were five?
No, 5 years
younger than you.
No. Yeah, something like that. Something like that, yeah.
Right.
And,
so that means you're 59 now.
Do you know what I was doing? I was doing work experience on the local paper, right?
Yeah.
And a photographer.
Work experience on the local paper when you were 16?
Yeah, absolutely.
How did you get that gig?
In the holidays. Just walked in and volunteered.
Did you?
Yeah, and a fellow who took me under his wing was a guy called Ken Evans.
Oh, yeah.
Now, Ken was chief photographer. We didn't have a picture editor in the weekly newspaper.
Yeah.
But
no,
Ken,
you need one, do you?
But Ken, because he was chief photographer, had a company, Hillman Avenger. Right, you know, which
so
was...
you immediately latched onto this.
Oh, absolutely, yeah. You know, I thought I'm going to.
Well, you couldn't drive though, when you're 16.
No, I thought I was going to learn to drive next year, 17. I'll be able to borrow the old Hillman Avenger, you know, go around and pick up a load of birds.
It's always an ulterior motive with everything you've done ever since childhood.
Yeah. But anyway, one of the jobs was to cover the Duke of Westminster's 21st birthday party at Eton Hall, which is...
Well, Eton Hall, where's that?
It's his country seat in Cheshire.
Oh, OK.
And the King's School Chester is built on their land, you see what I mean?
Yeah. Right.
That's why he's
chairman.
Why
do you think this is such a great thing?
Well, because
why
I
Why have such admiration of this bloke?
I think it's incredible.
Well, he gets bucket loads of money for literally doing nothing.
Yeah. Anyway...
Just because he inherited something from a king many, many centuries ago.
Anyway, he wasn't the Duke of Westminster at the time. His father was.
Oh, OK.
Right? And
so
he,
what was he then?
Well, he was...
Did they have a title? If you
he was...
Next in line.
I think he was Earl of Chester.
Oh, OK.
I think he was Earl of Chester or something like that.
Right.
So anyway, we go along to this party, and all Ken had to do was take a few pictures and all that kind of stuff.
Yeah.
But in the end, Ken turned out to be a bit of... Well, more of a groveler than I was, and spent the night rushing around getting Gerald.
I'm calling him my lord.
Yeah, my lord, yeah, and getting Gerald. No,
See,
my Earl.
Appalling.
My Earl, you know.
It's terrible.
Getting Gerald. And Gerald treated Ken, who's probably dead by now, because he was about 16
well,
in those days.
So.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. And Gerald Earl Grosvenor treated Ken like his personal servant, you know. And he used to say, oh, Ken... What a bloody camera, and get me another drink, you know.
That's shocking. And what were you doing during all this period?
Just watching it all, you know. Actually, I'll tell you what I was doing. One of the reasons why you weren't
nicking the family silver.
No, I wasn't nicking the family silver. But what's interesting is, in those days, I mean, these days, cameras are all digital and all that. In those days, you had to power your camera flash with a big battery that you carried around.
Yeah, right.
You know, we talked about old mobile
phones. Yeah, and it had that big sort of big lead that came
big
out
lead,
of the flash.
Absolutely. And so I used to carry Ken's battery around with me, but I had to walk near him because of this...
Battery carrier.
Yeah, the battery carrier I was.
Maybe
that's
why you've got this kind of problem with batteries now.
Maybe.
You know, carrying that battery around somehow knackered your relationship with batteries.
Yeah, absolutely. But another interesting thing was, at that party, right, a chap who I later worked with on the Daily Express was there from the Manchester office.
Oh, yeah.
A guy called Jerry Dempsey.
Okay.
And Jerry's been dead many years. He was a Welshman.
Did he drink himself to death?
Oh, yeah. Terrible drunk.
Yeah.
I mean, outrageous drunk. So drunk he couldn't sometimes remember which paper he was working for, because he'd worked for every paper in Manchester over the years and got sacked by them all. But he was a great writer.
Yeah.
But He went outside, right? He went out the like the.
This is the same party.
This is the same party, yeah. And he, in one of the rooms, you know, there's like, you know, cocktails being taken. Mm. He went out the back and he urinated all over the then Duke of Westminster's roses, prize roses.
Dear God.
Yeah, seriously, no joke. And because the, you know, the elderly Duke of Westminster, you know, Gerald's
father. Was he not there then?
Yeah, he was there, but he's in a different room.
Yeah.
Anyway, about a week later, the editor of the Daily Express got a note from the Duke of Westminster saying, please pass on my best regards to your wonderful reporter, Gerard Dempsey. Tell him he can, using the word pee to explain urinate, you know, on my roses any time he likes. They've bloomed beautifully since that night. Thank you. That was it? That was the note.
So they knew what he'd done.
How bizarre.
Yeah, it is bizarre. Now, we're running very late on the show this morning. Coming up next, we're going to talk to a couple of food bloggers who are going to help you out with what you should be eating at this time of year and what they eat in different parts of the world as well.
Because, what do they know about it?
What?
What do they know about it?
Well, they're experts on food.
Oh, yeah. So they're experts on food telling me what I should eat.
Yeah.
I'm an expert on my own food because I own my own palate. And I know what my
palate wants.
Yeah, I know what my palate wants.
What palate?
And it's probably not the sort of junk that they're going to try and force upon me.
Well, I don't think you should prejudge them.
Well, I'll tell you what, I'll wait and get them on the phone. We'll find out.
No, we're going to be talking to Gillian Sipkins.
Gillian Sipkins?
Yeah. And Eden Dranger.
What?
Eden Dranger.
Is that a man or a woman?
It's a woman.
Right.
They're both women.
Oh, that's good.
Yeah. I'm always very happy about that now.
Yes, because I'm always very respectful.
Sid's a sexist coming up
ladies.
Next on TalkSport.
TalkSport on DAB Digital Radio and 1089 and 1053 AM.
Freedom for sport.
Can we kick it? Yes, we can. TalkSport.
Talk Sport, we are the two Mikes. It is, of course, just 2 days to go until Christmas. Porky, unfortunately, is already getting Grinch-like and very, very humbug-like by not allowing me to have any mince pies
I think it's disgraceful in the middle of a
Christmas,
live show.
Christmas biscuits. Well, you know, it's that time of year. Mm. Now, I'm delighted to say we're going to have to talk about some food because, I mean, we know you've got your own problems with food.
I haven't got any problems.
We'll talk to Eden Dranger right now and Gillian Sipkins, who are both in charge of the Snack and Life Hacks podcast. Mm. Gillian and Eden, a very good morning to you. Welcome to the show.
Hello, good morning.
Yeah, good morning to you both. Thank you very much indeed for joining us. It is a thrill to have you on the two mics.
Thank you for having us.
Oh, stop it. He gets like this whenever we have women on the show. He doesn't know how to talk to women, basically.
Now,
we're going to have to try and do this in some kind of order, otherwise we'll be talking at the same time.
Yeah.
Do you mind, Gillian, if we start with you? Obviously, Christmas.
Oh, please.
Christmas is a time when everybody basically eats way too much. I've just been in receipt of a massive hamper of food from my sister from Fortnum & Mason's, which has got things like venison pate. You know, it's got all sorts of cheese in there. I don't know when I'm going to eat it. I don't know how I'm going to eat it. What are you supposed to do with all this food?
Oh my gosh! You know, if does she have a dog?
Yeah, I got a dog. But I can't give cheese to the dog. It's not going to be good for him.
Oh, come on. You can give cheese to a dog. You just can't give onion or grapes to a dog.
Yeah, that's true.
Or chocolate. Or
chocolate.
Fine.
Yeah.
Just turn it off on him.
But that's the thing. I mean, we all get all this food at this time of year. I mean, I'm sitting here. I've had one mince pie already. I might have another one. Porky, my fellow broadcaster here, is upset with me because he thinks I shouldn't eat while we're on the radio. But, I mean, what are you meant to do?
No, you know what? I think that you give yourself a break. Like, this is the time of year where everybody knows that you're overeating. And that it's okay. You know, like, the rest of the year, everybody can look at you sideways, but this is the one time where you can really stuff your face, even when you're on the radio.
Mm-hmm. Even when you're on the radio? Well, I'm not sure we should be eating when we're addressing people, but Eden, if I could
Eden,
I'm sorry, if I could just address this one to you. I sometimes wonder whether you can give advice on what people should eat at Christmas because there is such a diverse range of goodies on offer. How can you possibly tell somebody to go down one direction of gorgeous food if there's so much else around?
Yeah, no, I totally understand. It's like going to a restaurant and you always get very overwhelmed if they have too many things to choose from.
Yep.
And it's actually, it makes me always wonder at those restaurants, like, are they making these things good? Mm. They're making so many of these things. So I like the route of going, like, just the traditional simple route and offering, like, less of a selection, but making them just super excellent.
Oh, I totally agree with you, Ed. And in fact, a new chain of restaurants has just opened.
Oh, we've been so polite tonight.
Yeah.
Normally, he's very rude to our guests, but he's had a look at your pictures and decided he quite likes you.
Well, I have to say, ladies, we have had less attractive guests on the show than yourselves. That's all I can say. Can I tell you, we've just opened a new, a new chain of restaurants has opened in London.
What do you mean, we?
Hang on. And it's called Lobster and Burger. And that's all they serve, lobster
surf
and burgers.
And turf.
Oh, yeah.
I love it. I love it already. Well, Jill and I were just in London over the summer, so I'm surprised we didn't see that.
We didn't see that.
Did you go to Borough Market when you were here?
No.
That's a resounding no.
I don't think we did.
You didn't go to Borough Market. You're supposed to be food bloggers. It's like the world's capital of fantastic food. It's just by London Bridge Station. I go there all the time.
Well,
you'll have to come back.
Next time we're in town, you'll have to take us there.
Don't worry, ladies. Right. This guy on my left is very overweight, and he goes to places that sell fatty food very cheaply. So you girls, with your exquisite taste, wouldn't go anywhere near Borough Market.
How do you know they've got exquisite taste?
Well, they have got exquisite
taste. Why? How do you know that?
Well, that's what they do. They're experts, not like you.
Well, I've never heard of Borough Market.
Yeah, but you fat fool, that's where you go to get all that rubbish food that you eat. These ladies are sophisticats, you know?
Yeah,
don't worry about it.
Hang on. The great thing about the Borough Market experience is you can go there and you can have all sorts of amazing, you know, Argentinian food, Spanish food. They've got big bowls of paella, but you can also walk around with a glass of champagne, which is very civilised, as far as I'm concerned.
Now, talking about that, because this boy is a drink fanatic, Gillian, if I could ask you, how important is it to get the right sort of drink, you know, to complement your food? Should you really, you know, have special...
Drink five bottles of Pinot Grigio with a Christmas dinner.
Yeah, I mean, should you really have a special white wine for the sweet and all this kind of stuff?
Well, they say that white wines are for fish and poultry and that red wine goes with red meat. But I say... Especially over the holidays, I think you can drink whatever you want, and the more the better. Really.
Oh, I totally agree.
Well, no one's paying attention.
Porky here basically drinks an awful lot every single day. This is a man who goes to the pub for breakfast, right? So with a full English breakfast, he usually has... He once told me you can have two pints of beer and a full English breakfast at 9 a.m. for less than 10 quid, which is pretty good.
This is ridiculous.
That is pretty good. And, you know, the beautiful thing about champagne is that you can drink that in the morning and the evening, and nobody bats an eye. So I would stick with that.
Yeah, I totally agree with you.
Why don't you tell Gillian and Eden what your favourite dinner is, right?
Yes.
And maybe they could describe what wine you should have with that.
Yes, my favourite dinner would be...
Fish fingers.
No. My favourite dinner would be a sirloin steak with spinach and...
Boiled spinach, right?
Yeah, with spinach and sautéed potatoes. How about that, ladies?
Oh, what do you think, Eden? I would go with a red wine.
Red wine, yeah, definitely, yeah. I'd go for something like a Fleury or maybe a Bone, Châteauneuf du Pape.
Huh? He's trying to show off. He knows nothing about wine. He knows nothing about wine. He thinks a Fleury is something you eat steak with, which is really, really not good.
You know what a Fleury is here in the States?
Mm-hmm.
It's a milkshake at McDonald's. Am I right, Eden? The McFlurry?
Right.
The McFlurry, that's right. Very good.
Yeah. Well,
hey, by the way, I hear McDonald's are in trouble. They're closing down a load of franchises in Japan, apparently. And this year, for the first time, they're not actually opening more branches in America for the first time since they ever opened up. Are the Americans losing interest in fast food, do you think?
You know what? I think we could all take a break, right?
Mm-hmm. Right. I mean, we just have so much better burgers elsewhere that I think they're just, you know, they just can't live up to McDonald's is offering.
Right. Exactly.
That's
right.
All.
I know what you mean.
Like
we're all
Five Guys and all that other burger chains are just.
But it's a lot more. I mean, that's the thing that's happened, hasn't it? I mean, a Borough Market is like this as well. I mean, you can get lots of great food, but I mean, it's a lot more expensive. Really a lot more expensive. I mean, you go to McDonald's and you can take the kids there and get out of there for dinner if you wish to, for a 10 quid. You go to take them to one of these other expensive burger places where the food is a lot better, it's going to cost you three times as much.
That's right, and that's always been the beauty of McDonald's, I suppose. But, you know, I heard that actually Subway surpassed McDonald's in the number of restaurants they have worldwide.
I don't know
if that was a rumor or not, but I think people are trying to eat a little bit better, even, you know.
Yeah.
I think you can get out the door for maybe just a few dollars more or quid more
quid.
In
So tell us, where did you go when you were in London then?
Where did we go?
Oh,
you know where we went?
Tayab.
To get pee?
Tayab. That was so good.
Oh, Tayab.
That was our favorite experience of all. That was the, it was an Indian restaurant.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, some great Indian restaurants.
It was so delicious.
Mm. Yeah.
You know, better than anything we've had in the States.
I thought it was the Red Fort. Now, Edding, can I ask you this, please? We know that turkey plays a huge part of American life on Thanksgiving, but does it still play a huge part in American life on Christmas Day? Because in this country, in Great Britain, right, it is the staple meat of the day. 90% of people eat turkey on Christmas Day.
Yes, I mean, I think Americans still buy turkey. My last check at the grocery store, the turkey selection was still very much prominent, so it's still there. Also, I feel like Americans, I don't know if you guys do this too, but we're really big on ham.
Ham, yeah, I like ham. I like honey roast ham.
Right, so people like that, but to be quite honest, I feel like most people just buy that prepared already, and they don't actually prepare it.
Yeah, they do, yeah. They just. I thought you liked lean ham, anyway.
I do like lean ham, but honey roast ham is lean.
How do you know?
I like breaded ham as well.
Breaded's not lean, is it?
It is, yeah, it is.
No, it's not. How can it be lean if
it's
breaded?
I like ham any which way.
Yeah, I
do. I like it fried. You could put it on a piece of cardboard, it'd be fine.
Yeah, no, I totally agree with you. I like it with cheese, ham and cheese. Absolutely delicious.
This is the most boring conversation I've ever heard.
No, it's not. No,
it is.
It's very interesting.
About ham and cheese.
It's very interesting.
Ridiculous. What are you guys doing for Christmas? Tell us.
Oh, well, sometimes we go out to a Chinese restaurant, to be honest.
Okay.
To avoid all of the...
are you in New York?
All the masses. I will be in Chicago and Eden will be in L.A. for this Christmas.
Oh, okay.
Oh, I tell you what, Gillian, if you're going to be in Chicago, I'd love to be with you because I want a blanket of
what
snow.
What do you mean you'd love to be with her?
A blanket of snow.
You want a blanket?
A blanket of snow 3 feet deep, okay?
Throw a blanket of water over you.
I want the lakes to be frozen so I can go out skiing on them, ice skating on them and all that kind of stuff, you know.
You can't ice skate.
And where I don't want to be, Eden, is in L.A., having Christmas lunch on the beach, you know? I don't want to be a Malibu beach bum on Christmas Day.
Oh, come on. Santa needs a vacation, too.
Santa needs a vacation. Well, he only works one day a year. Anyway.
Colder in London right now.
Yeah.
So,
yeah, it's too mild in London. I'm thinking of going to somewhere like Norway.
Oh, good. You're going away?
Yeah, I might do.
Do you know what they eat in Norway?
They eat blubber, don't they?
No, they eat roasted lamb's head.
Oof, not having that, thank you.
You'd love that.
They eat lutefisk.
Yeah.
Yeah, in Greenland, they eat raw blubber and fermented birds.
Ew.
What's wrong with that?
Forget that.
Well, that's so good.
See, I'm a great believer in experimenting with food and trying new things, right? Whereas this guy, he has a staple diet. All he eats is steak, fish fingers, fish and chips, spaghetti bolognese.
There's nothing wrong with that.
What else is on your list?
No, it's
that's about it, isn't it?
Baked beans on toast.
Baked beans on toast. I mean, this man has got the imagination of a dead squirrel, I promise you.
I think not.
Anyway. What's the most unusual thing? What's the most unusual thing both of you have ever tried eating? Gillian first and then Eden.
For me, the first thing that comes to mind would probably be alligator.
Alligator.
Ooh. Yeah, well, it tastes like chicken, doesn't it?
Yeah.
You know, it does. It's a little chewy, but it tastes like chicken-ish.
Yeah.
You know, most things can taste like chicken if you really think about it.
As long as you can get it off the cartilage,
I would say that would be.
I've had that. Well, Eden, what about you?
Right.
Oh, I'm trying to think. I did have... this is kind of popular, actually, in L.A. We have a very big, large Mexican influence. I've had, like, chocolate-covered crickets.
Mm-hmm. Chocolate-covered crickets?
Which is surprisingly not terrible.
Yeah, I had some of those. I had some of those once. They were kind of sort of dry roasted, and they actually tasted like trail mix. I thought they were quite good.
Yeah.
Yeah, it was a little nutty.
It got a little crunch.
A little nutty.
Yeah. Yeah.
It does. I wouldn't snack on it regularly, but it was fine.
Yeah. Be good to put some out.
It got me less scared to see one.
Be good to put some out for the family at Christmas, wouldn't it? Just watch how they react to eating
it. Lovely.
Oh, no thanks, no. Give me an alligator sandwich and make it snappy. Ha, 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 ha.
Yeah, he's a very funny man, isn't he?
Yeah.
Now, just before I let you guys go, I'm going to let Porky, my colleague here, give you a Christmas greeting. But let me tell you this from one of our Twitter followers, Sean, who says this. Porky was ready to attack the guests until he found out they were women.
Mm-hmm.
And then that changed to, I totally agree with you ladies.
I totally agree
with you. Hashtag fraud.
No, not at all. It has been, ladies, can I say, it has been an absolute pleasure and an honour to have you on our show. Thank you very much indeed.
Oh, so, thank you for having us.
So near to Christmas.
Thank you for coming.
I hope you both have a wonderful festive season. And we hope that we'll be able to get you back on our show sometime in 2016. Thank you ever so much.
Absolutely. Thank you.
And have a great Christmas, Gillian and Eden there from a blog called Snack and Life Hacks.
Yeah.
I don't know what to say, really.
Nice people. What do you mean?
I think I'm going to have to go and be ill.
Why?
Because of the way you talk to these women.
What do you mean?
It's just shocking.
What's wrong with being respectful?
Yeah, well, there's something wrong with the way that you talk to women. That's what's wrong with it.
The trouble with you
is... It's creepy. And I'll read you a load of tweets that say exactly that.
You were asking them questions down the line, but not specifying if you wanted to talk to Gillian or Eden. At least I was polite enough to say, Eden, this is your question. Gillian, this is your question. All you got was a cacophony of mixed replies. And I tell you something, I think our millions of listeners will realise how respectful I was to women. That's the way.
Here's one of our many women listeners, and this is what she has to say. Okay. Becky in New Zealand.
Yes.
Throwing up here, Porky's sickly creeping to those two wonderful lady guests is beyond belief. No wonder there is no first Mrs. Parry around.
Excuse me. That's very harsh.
Well, I'm going to be reading a lot more of those out coming up very soon. Don't forget, you can still vote in winners and losers. There's about 15 minutes left. It is still currently 52% to Porky, 48% to me.
Vote Porky, vote often.
If anybody wants me to win, you better get your skates on. This is Talk Sport.
We took the all-new Mitsubishi L200 Series 5 across the globe for 18 days and 4,267 miles. We conquered the Sahara Desert and the Atlas Mountains to show the world the most manoeuvrable, economic, efficient, safest and capable pickup we've ever made. The Mitsubishi L200 Series 5, showing the world how it's done. Search Mitsubishi L200 and test the best. Where will the perfume shop take you this Christmas? Back to that amazing Christmas party where you met a girl. Or maybe the warm August day when that girl became the one. Or even the long sleepless night when the other half became us three. Whether you want to recall a special moment or create new memories, the perfume shop has got your perfect Christmas gift on the nose. The perfume shop is the leading perfume retailer on the high street with over 300 designer brands to choose from. Every store has a team of in-house scent gurus dedicated to finding precisely the right perfume gift for all your VIPs. So you're guaranteed to come up smelling of roses on Christmas Day too. Plus, the Perfume Shop Rewards Club Card offers the most generous loyalty scheme on the high street. Get exclusive bonus treats, win great prizes, and collect points to earn money off your next purchase. Here's to the memories this Christmas. The past, the present, and the future. The Perfume Shop. Where will it take you?
Christmas isn't just about football. There's some cricket on as well. Christmas 2015 on Talk Sport.
I will be rising from the ground like a skyscraper. Like a skyscraper. As the smoke clears, I will.
This is Talk Sport. We are the two mics. Coming up in the next hour, Ask Porky, of course. Within 10 minutes, we will probably be able to deliver the verdict in the winners and losers. At the moment, you're slightly edging it. Very close, though.
Yeah.
Very exciting stuff. Now, a couple of things I've got to do.
Right.
We had a phone call from Fergal, who's a lorry driver.
Fergal!
He didn't say where he was, but apparently he's out there somewhere and he's parked up with a bunch of his lorry driving mates.
Right.
And he's convinced them all to sit around and listen to this show.
Excellent. Where are they then?
Well, I just told you, he didn't say where he was.
Why didn't you find out?
Well, I wasn't on the phone to him.
I thought you were supposed to be a trained observer.
No, but I didn't speak to him.
He
rang up to speak to the burgeoning list of people answering the phones here at the TalkSport phone
bank. Why didn't they
ask
him?
Well, I don't know. Why
they're
you
incompetent.
Well, why don't you ask them? Now, here's one. Now, here's one from Ben, who says, Dear Mikes, this is why I love your show. In the midst of sordid tales of bladderisation, suddenly the essence of the modern existential dichotomy is expressed when MG says to MP, stop talking, this is Talk Sport.
Yes,
priceless.
Yes.
Now, would you like to know what other people made of your creeping to those two girls?
Wasn't creeping.
I think you were.
Nothing wrong being respectful to women.
Lord Rallo says, whenever there's attractive women on the show, old Porky gets worked up like he has a chance and throws MG under the bus.
Yeah, that's right, I do, yeah, because... because I don't think you're respectful enough, you see.
No, I see.
I think I know how Stephen, to treat women and you don't.
Stephen says, these two women are sophisticats, according to Porky. Yes. Is that the same sophisticats as the strip club in Marylebone?
Oh, come on. What on earth are you talking about? Mm. What on earth are you talking about? I've never been to a strip club in my life.
Haven't you?
And I wouldn't demean myself by doing it.
I saw you going into one.
You saw me going into one to ask if they had a television
to
watch the
football. Yeah, but you stayed in there.
I didn't stay
there. Yes, you did. You said you watched the game in there.
Yeah, in the foyer. They had a.
They didn't
a TV
have a foyer.
Foyer.
No, it was a bar.
There was a bar, and loads of women walking around topless. No. I didn't see any topless women.
Becky says this: Christmas dinner sorted a la Porky, lean ham, cheese, boiled vegetables, and a good McFlurry to wash the feast down.
That's right. Yeah, McFlurry. I forgot that McFlurry was like a whipped up ice cream or milkshake or something.
A McFlurry.
Of course, I'm talking about Flurry.
Yeah, Flurry. Yeah.
The French wine.
Graham in Bath says. MG. Yes. Oh, hang on. Something strange just happened here.
Something strange has happened here. Yeah, you've lost your place because you're so determined.
Well, I don't really think... No, I don't
you're
really
so
think...
determined to try and find some downer tweets page, about me.
The page just flipped. I don't think you should be being critical of me on the technology front. Do you? The man who can't work a mobile phone.
Listen.
Graham and Barr says this. MG, what would the two ladies make of Porky going to Wetherspoons? Mm. Why didn't he mention that when trying to impress the ladies?
Well, they wouldn't know what Wetherspoons was, would they? They were sophisticated... professional women. I mean, professional in the sense of
professional
food,
women. What do you
food.
Mean? No, well, what do you mean by that?
I mean experts in their field.
I see.
Now, listen, I'll tell you
one more here. Glenn says, what a creep Porky is. He didn't ask them if they had found a cure for cancer, did he?
Well, of course not. They were making a contribution to life in other ways.
Yeah.
Now, what I wanted to say to you was... I'll tell you who's...
What do you want to say?
I'll tell you who's died. And this guy was a massively significant...
This show is all about people dying.
Well, it's not about people
dying.
What's
going on about that?
Well, who else has died that we've talked about tonight?
Well, every night you tell me about somebody who died. The other night you were talking to me about some racing correspondent from the Times
Alan
died.
Lee. Yeah, he's a lovely lad, by the way.
Then you used Jimmy Hill disgracefully as if it was some kind of...
well, he did die.
Well, they all died, but the point is, why do you have to keep talking about people who died?
In fact, funny enough, do you remember a royal correspondent with ITN called Michael Cole?
Yes.
Who went on to become spokesman for Mohammed Al-Fayed.
That's right, yeah.
And the Harrods Empire and all that kind of stuff. And he was a lovely guy.
He was a lovely guy.
And he also became a director...
Dead as well?
No, he's not dead, no.
Right. He became Why are we talking about him, then?
I'll tell you. He became a director of Fulham, because Mohammed Al-Fayed owned Fulham.
Yeah.
Which means he...
He's not still a director, though, is he?
No, he's not, no. Because, of course, Mohammed Al-Fayed doesn't run Fulham
anymore. Shahid Khan owns it now.
And Shahid Khan owns it. And the day after he took over, had Michael Jackson's statue taken down.
Yes.
On the night Everton were playing at Fulham. And I saw the crane come in and take it away.
Mm. And things haven't gone well for Fulham ever since that statue disappeared.
Things haven't gone well. But anyway, Michael Cole actually was in touch with people last week talking about Jimmy Hill. Because Jimmy Hill, of course, he was a professional footballer with Fulham before he went on to do so many other things in life, you know. But he reminded people that Hill would leap vertically into the air several times after scoring his goals for Fulham, and reminds everybody he scored 5 at Doncaster Rovers.
Jimmy Hill did?
Yeah, Jimmy Hill scored 5 against Doncaster Rovers away. And he had this particular goal-scoring celebration where he would leap up like a kangaroo.
Oh, yeah.
And almost to the height of the crossbar.
Uh-huh.
Yeah, an amazing sort of...
it's not that amazing, is it?
Yeah, it is amazing.
Why?
It was
fantastic. Did he do it with a pipe in his mouth?
Didn't do it with a pipe in his mouth. But because there were no television cameras around in those days, nobody ever saw it.
Yeah, right.
No,
a lot of people agreed with me, though, when I said to you that there wasn't all sweetness and light in terms of Jimmy Hill, because he removed the maximum, wage and all that. And he also introduced the idea of more expensive tickets for football.
Yeah.
You know, it has now run out of control, like a sort of runaway train.
Yeah, well...
And, you know, he's largely responsible for letting go of the break.
Yeah, but, I mean, you know, footballers were ridiculously paid before the...
Well, you might say they were paid what they were worth.
All right, so where would...
Why ridiculously paid?
Where would the money go if it didn't go into the pockets of footballers?
What do you mean?
Where would the money go if it didn't go into the pockets of footballers?
Which money?
The huge, vast amounts of billions of pounds, which is now paid to football clubs.
Well, it might go into subsidising ticket prices,
for example. It would go into the pockets of the directors.
It does go into the pockets of the directors already.
No, it doesn't.
Yes, it does.
Not largely. Mostly it goes to the players.
Everyone who's associated with Premier League football in this country is doing very well, thank you very much. I don't think any of them are going to a pauper's prison.
But what I'm saying is...
Maybe some of the money could filter down to grassroots football, which is what we always hear about.
It wouldn't.
No, but that's what it should do.
In the days of
That's what it should do.
In the days of the maximum wage, people paid £5 to go through the turnstile and stand on a terrace, yeah. and there could be, like, at Charlton, 70,000 people.
Yeah.
All those £5 added together added to huge sums of money, like £25,000 a week in gate money.
Yeah.
I mean, unheard of. That's the equivalent of 2.5 million these days, right. literally, OK?
Yeah.
Well, if you couldn't pay that to the players because of the maximum wage...
Yeah, but it was much more affordable to go to football in those days.
Yeah, the guys who would have taken it would have been all the directors.
No, I don't agree.
And then you'd have had a situation where the people running the club are making a mess of running the club
and
not building a proper stand.
So you, as man of the people...
would be filthy rich.
So you, as man of the people, prefer the money to come into the club, go to all the very wealthy football players and as many of the wealthy directors as you possibly can muster,
no.
but not to have it in any way put into grassroots football, not in any way to promote kids' football and not in any way to make tickets cheaper for the fans.
No.
What man of the people are you?
No, human nature says...
Never mind about human nature. Not everybody's greedy like you.
No, but you don't understand the market, see? And the market says supply and demand, and the supply and demand for the best players to go to the biggest clubs means that the footballers will always take 99% of the money. That's the way it works. Directors don't take a hell of a lot.
It doesn't have to work like that.
But look,
oh, you tell me there's a director of a Premier League football club who doesn't take a hell of a lot of money out of it.
Well... Bill Kenwright, who's the chairman of Everton Football Club.
Who's worth how much?
Doesn't take a penny out of football.
Who's worth how much?
Doesn't take
Who's worth how much?
It's irrelevant. He does
not
take...
Irrelevant.
It is. He doesn't take a penny
irrelevant.
Out of football.
Of course it's not. How is it irrelevant?
Because he's a director in the sense that he's chairman and owner of Everton, but he doesn't take a penny out of the game.
Rubbish. I don't believe that.
Well, I'm sorry.
I don't believe it.
I want you to retract that.
No, I don't believe it. Well, you show me evidence that he takes no money out of football.
He takes no money out of football.
None at all.
I can show you the annual report. I'm a shareholder. I've just had it.
So when he goes to Everton, and he sits down in his seat, which he doesn't pay for, right? How is he not taking that for free?
He owns the club.
So that's, he's taking that, isn't he?
Well, that's like you saying, how come when you go into your flat and sit down in your armchair, you're not paying for it? You own it.
No, it's not.
Well, you don't own
it.
You rent it.
No, because he's using the profits. There's nothing wrong with it, but he's using the profits to sit there for free.
No, that's what a ridiculous, why is he paying for the seat, stupid then? Argument.
Well, it's not. You're saying he takes nothing out of football.
He doesn't.
He gets a free seat, doesn't he?
What an idiotic argument.
He has free food. He has free drink, I presume, when he's there.
Because he was a successful...
He invites people there and he entertains them. Does he pay for that himself?
What a stupid, specious argument.
No, it's not specious. Because you're saying he takes nothing out of the...
He doesn't take anything out of football. He gives to football. Because he was a successful businessman and you're the world's biggest entrepreneurial theatre business,
if he can afford to
he was
do a
able
job
to
and not
raise
be
the money in the consortium to buy Everton Football Club, right?
Yeah.
So I think he's entitled to sit in a seat which says
of
chairman.
Of course he's entitled
it.
To it, but what you're not entitled to do is make out like he's some kind of saintly figure who doesn't take any money out of football.
He is the
it's
only,
ridiculous.
He's the only chairman in the Premier League who doesn't pay himself a salary.
He doesn't
pays
take
himself
a,
nothing.
He doesn't take a fee.
He
works for Everton for nothing.
He has a driver who drives him from London to Everton and back for all home games.
Uh-huh.
And he pays for the petrol himself.
No, that's very good of him.
So he doesn't take any money out of football. Yeah, but he doesn't. But you said all these executives take your money out of football.
No, they do. You cannot,
I'm only stating the point.
Look, I know that you're stuck on this guy, right? But the point is, bottom line, he takes money out of his own club. Of course he does.
No, he doesn't. And I'm only stating the point.
He doesn't pay for a seat. He doesn't pay for the entertainment that he gets there.
Because
he doesn't pay for a ticket. He doesn't pay for all the people that come and are entertained at Everton at his behest, does he?
Because you know you've made a ridiculous statement.
I haven't made
you're
a ridiculous
all
statement.
You're defensive and aggressive
not getting
now
at all defensive.
Because you know you've been found
no,
out.
No, you will never hear anything bad said about Bill Kenwright. I'm not saying anything bad about him. All I'm saying is that clearly if he owns a football club, he will be taking something out of it.
No, I listen, if people say something bad about...
I mean, next you'll be saying he's like the Mother Teresa of the Premier League.
If people say something bad about Mr. Kenwright, and I've spent years defending him, then you just have to react to it. But when people tell lies about him, like you are doing...
I haven't told lies.
You are.
No, you're telling me that he takes nothing out of the
place. He takes nothing out of the game.
Well, I don't believe it.
Well, you can believe what you like, but you don't know what you're talking about.
Okay. There's no point getting grumpy about it, just because he's your favourite bloke in the entire world.
I'm just astonished that you can make such silly statements with such lack of knowledge. You know, out of pure ignorance, you...
It's amazing. A lot of that goes on in this show.
Suddenly blazing away, you know, on a subject
because,
you know nothing
because
about.
I don't believe you.
So I think really you could shut your gob.
No, really? Okay. Yeah. Well, now who's losing the rag? No, Andrew says this. I can't believe Mike Parry said about the alligator sandwich gag. It's a crocodile sandwich.
Yeah, well,
hashtag plank.
Alligator fits, believe me.
Baby Mo says only Porky would go into a strip club to watch TV.
Yeah, well, there's only one around in Soho. There are no sports bars in Soho. Well, until our mate opened one in...
There are plenty of sports bars in Soho,
actually.
What's
that street, by the way? Because your daughter's boyfriend worked next door.
Yeah, yeah,
so you
yeah,
should know was... the name of the street.
Yeah, I can't... Why should I know the name of the street?
Began with R.
Began with R?
Yeah.
Well, it's off Shaftesbury Avenue.
It's off Shaftesbury Avenue, and it's opposite the theatre where the ceiling fell in on my friend.
That's right, yeah.
You know, the strange tale of a dog in the night.
That's it, yeah.
I shouldn't remember the name of the street.
Can't remember. Yeah. District was the name of the club.
Oh, was it? Okay, yeah.
Well,
the bar was called the Sports Bar and Grill.
Yeah. Brendan says, Porky's like one of those creepy, perverted uncles you try to keep your girlfriend away from at the family Christmas party.
Oh, yeah, really? Why is that, then?
I don't know.
No, exactly. What a silly thing to say.
No, I know.
Without justification.
Well, I think he's referring to the way you were talking to those two girls. Now,
just because I'm respectful to
it's
women.
It's coming up to 3 o'clock. We have to close the voting on winners and losers. We'll reveal the result coming up next.
Absolutely.
After the news and sports headlines at 3 o'clock with Alex Porky.
Thanks, Mike. Good morning.
On digital radio and 1089 and 1053 AM. Talk Sport.
Good morning, I'm Mike Graham. He's Mike Parry. You're listening to Two Mics. We're keeping you entertained throughout the night. Very exciting hour coming up. We will announce the winner of winners and losers. Currently about 5 minutes past three. The voting stopped 5 minutes ago. We'll report very, very shortly who is the victor. Could Mr. Parry complete his hat-trick and get the score back up to 13-6? I'm sorry to report, though, having just returned from a brief sojourn out of the studio, somebody has crushed a mince pie right in front of me on my working papers. Is that you that did that?
Nothing to do with me.
You didn't do it?
I didn't do it.
Well, who else would crush a mince pie in front of me?
Well, somebody smashed up your mince pie and left it in crumbs all over your desk.
It's disgusting.
Well,
it's disgusting.
It's nothing to do
with
me.
Do I have to check the CCTV?
Yeah, I was out of the studio as well, so I don't know,
really?
Mate. I'm sorry.
So
I'll help you track down the culprit, because, you know, can't go around doing that to other people's property.
Schweinhund is all I have to say.
Yeah.
Ask Porky coming up a little bit later
anyway,
on.
Anyway, it's not really smashed up. You're exaggerating.
Well,
rubbish.
I might eat it, actually, but it's horrible. You've made a real mess of my running order.
I haven't done anything. No.
I'm going to send a picture out of it, people can judge. 08717223344. You're listening to Two Mics with me, Mike Graham, and Mike Parry on Talk Sport. This is Talk Sport. We are the two mics, and I have to say, I mean, you've done many things to me in the past, you know, so crushing a mince pie, I suppose, is the least of my worries in terms of some of the stuff you've done in my fairly recent past, you know, dumping my apartment so that I had to sell it, or not sell it, rather, give it away back to the bank. Anyway, so, I mean, I should have expected something like that, I suppose. I'm going to tweet a picture out now, and people will know that only you could have done up something like that.
Why would I do that?
Because it's the kind of person you are.
Why would I?
You know, you wreak revenge on people.
Why would I?
You didn't like me having to go Bill Kenwright, so you decided to smash my mince pie up.
No. I don't like you eating mince pies during the show.
But I'm still going to eat it.
But I would never stoop to the level
I'm still going to eat it.
I would never stoop to the level of...
This is kind of a schoolboy prank, the kind of thing you would do.
Smashing up... I mean,
shocking.
Honestly, fancy accusing me of smashing up mince pies. Well, I've got anything better to do in life.
Well, you haven't got anything better to do, have you? That's the whole point.
Excuse me.
Now, do you want me to give you the results
of please.
Winners and losers?
Yes,
an
please.
Extraordinary amount of votes cast. 2,036 votes cast.
Excellent.
Which I think is the most votes we've ever had in any of these polls.
Yes.
It is, of course, winners and losers, and the current score is 13-5.
Yes.
The new figures are Mike Parry, 52%.
Yes! Woo, 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 woo!
Mike Graham, 48%.
Woo, woo, woo!
So by a very narrow margin, you've won.
And
so congratulations.
Thank you very much indeed.
And it's now 13-6.
And how many successive ones have I won?
That's three in a row.
Three in a row. Thank you very much indeed.
How many do you think I won?
On a roll.
How many do you think I won in a row?
Well, no idea, mate.
And it was 10.
Yeah, but that's history.
It was 10.
That's all history,
So when you get to 10 in a row, then we can have a conversation.
That's all history.
It's 13-6, so I'm still ahead of you by a very, very large margin.
Yeah. Richard here says something which is quite significant.
Mm.
How does Mike Parry put up with the MG drivel every night? The genius versus the gawp. I don't know what a gawp is, but you are one. So that's,
I don't know what
so
it is.
I like
are you
that.
Sure he's got that around the right
yeah,
way?
Yeah, that's from Richard. And Enzi says, Mike Parry wins. Love the show tonight, fellas. Keep it up. Ha, ha, ha. What's the strip club good? I don't know. I didn't go in there to watch anybody strip off. I went in there to watch football.
Yeah, but only
there are
you
no sports bars in Soho.
Yeah, there are. There are loads of them.
There isn't.
Here's one from Zach in Plymouth. Porky seriously needs to participate in some Rogerisation instead of getting his thrill live on air and trying desperately to impress those women.
Oh, come on. I was only being respectful.
Mm.
It says here...
Jay the cabbie says the name of the street in Soho, Porky, is Rupert Street.
Rupert
Absolutely
Street.
Right.
It certainly is.
It is Rupert Street. So you got the initial right.
Thank you very much indeed.
Mm.
It says here, this is terrible, from JPK, the cloying schizophrenic propensities of Mike Parry on
Blimey.
Full display with two female guests. Disingenuous. That's very harsh.
Well, it was disingenuous.
By the way, I'm reading these from my revived old knackered phone, which now has to be charged up every 20 minutes.
Mm.
That's outrageous.
I'm just sending out a little tweet here that says, my crushed mince pie, thanks to the Grinch, Mike Parry. I'm going to start calling you the Grinch.
What's a Grinch?
What's a Grinch?
Yeah.
The Grinch that stole Christmas. You don't know the book?
No.
You don't know the movie?
No.
Starring the guy from Dumb and Dumber.
No. Well, that suits you, Dumb and Dumber. Right, one here from Chris. Where do you vote winners and losers? Also, can you get the button monkeys on the case? Reception is terrible.
Where do you vote?
Yeah.
Well, the voting's finished now.
Yeah, voting's finished, yeah.
Although
the last
winners and losers of the year, I suppose, will be next Monday, won't it?
Yeah, of course it will.
But that'll be on the daytime show.
On the daytime show,
Between 10 and 1 in the morning.
Between 10 and 1 daytime, 10 a.m. to 1 p.m, we will be with you live on your radio, and we will be bringing to daytime radio all the elements of our show, all the elements of the two mics.
Now, let me read one, this one to you. Muzo says, Mike, can I change my vote after listening to Porky's fawning to the foodie blog girls and his football director's rant?
Excuse me. Well, hang on. There's one here which says, loving the interview on the two mics. He's talking about the interview with the ladies. So obviously that one, and that comes from, who does that come from? Loving the interview. Hang on. Oh, yes, from Paul. Paul, thank you very much indeed.
I bet you don't remember their names, do you?
Of course I do.
Who are they then? The two girls we were talking
about. Jennifer and Eden.
Jennifer.
Yes.
Gillian.
Gillian and Eden. Gillian and Eden.
Right. Now, let me put this to you, right?
Okay.
You know, we've often said that you have what we call bots in Twitter, right, which are automatic accounts that will be activated at any one time to vote in certain directions,
what's
right?
What's this?
It's an automatic account. It's basically a fake account. Which some people use to get votes.
Bots.
Bots, B-O-T-S, yeah.
Yeah, I've never heard of that.
You never heard of it?
No.
Well, I can tell you that when I was monitoring the voting process earlier on in the day, right, there were at least 10 people who put out this tweet. It was addressed to at the two mites, at IROMG, at Mike Parrier. It said, I've not heard it yet, but Porky gets my vote.
Yes.
Exactly the same words.
Yes.
Exactly the same tweet from 10 different accounts.
I can't help
How can you explain that?
I can't help it if people independently
How
want
can
to follow
you explain
me.
That?
Well, I can't explain it because I didn't
How
know anything
How can they
about
send
it?
Out exactly the same tweet
I didn't know
without being
about
run
it.
By the same account?
I don't know anything about it.
Well, I think it's very suspicious.
I can't believe it.
I think it's very suspicious.
You've put out a picture of your crushed mince pie.
I did, yeah.
You are pathetic.
Well, because you crushed it.
I did. How dare you? I am not accepting responsibility for that crushed mince pie whatsoever.
Well, everybody knows that you did it.
No, they
don't.
That's
the kind of thing you would do.
I'd like some response from our listeners,
please. Disgusting behaviour, but I wouldn't expect any less from Porky.
Well, I think what is disgusting behaviour is trying to munch through a mince pie when you're live on air. Disrespectful to our millions of listeners.
Kevin says, Porky definitely bashed your mince pie, just like your karate bashed the water.
I don't think so. I don't think so.
And Roy says, what a nasty, pathetic little man smashing up mince pies this close to Christmas.
What?
It's sacrilege.
What?
He says, you're jealous of my Christmas as well, that's why.
I don't think you should be eating them, that's all. Right, now then, don't move the lid, as if he looks at it, he'll think it's a mirror. What does that mean? That's from FFDU, whatever that
don't
is.
Don't lift the lid of what?
No, don't move the lid, as if he looks at it, he'll think it's a mirror. I don't know that
I think he means the lid of the mince pie.
Oh, OK, lid of the mince pie.
But it's not actually a lid, is it?
Yeah.
I don't think he's thought that one through.
No. So it says here, and this is a good one, Nico says, come on, MG, why would Porky kill an innocent, fancy-looking pie? Don't be a plank. So there you go.
Well, I don't know who else would have done it. It didn't happen by itself. Now, let me talk to... not talk to, let me ask you about this. Did you see that picture of the rocket today coming down and landing sort of upwards, as it
were? It's like watching Thunderbird 1 land.
It was, wasn't it?
Amazing to see an upright rocket, a vertical rocket like that.
Very
coming
exciting.
To ground.
Very exciting.
It was incredible.
I was going to ask you why they've never done that before. Remember you said that in the days of the Russian cosmonauts and all of that, they didn't have any real ability to land anywhere except just to crash land.
That's right,
they crash-landed on the steps.
That's what they did.
Or they crash-landed in the sea.
They crash-landed one on the moon.
But now...
A few days
now,
before the American moon landing.
This is amazing sort of you know, new technology, isn't it? Where you can take a rocket up in the air
and
then bring it back down and land it exactly in the same spot.
I know, it's incredible.
It is incredible.
How does it come down to Earth without falling to the ground?
I think you must use these kind of thrusters.
Retro rockets.
Retro thrusters or something like that.
Something
we might
like
have
that,
to get a space expert on to explain it to us.
I think that's a good idea. He might have to fix it up later in the week.
Now, here's one from Geordie Bry. He says, well done, Porky, for pulling one back in Winners and Losers. You're still a loser fighting a lost cause. He says, I'm Team MG.
Yeah.
And he says, Porky, I hope you have a good Christmas and a miserable Boxing Day when your team gets smashed off the Toon Army.
No, I don't think they will, actually. 5:30 game, that, by the way.
The
old
the
Parry clan will be gathered around the telly in the home cinema. On the South Coast,
the home
watching
cinema.
That one. Yeah, it's got a home cinema, yes.
A home cinema?
The home cinema, yeah.
Well, what do you mean a home cinema?
Well, it's in the top floor of the family residence.
Well, has it got, like, cinema seats and everything?
Yes.
Have you got those, what do you call those, premium seats that they have now in the cinema?
Armchairs.
So that you can sit in one?
Armchairs.
No, but has it got proper cinema seats, I'm saying?
You
know, you go to, like, a proper Hollywood mansion.
No.
They've actually got a screening room. So it's not really a cinema.
Well, it's
like a big TV screen in the roof.
It's like a 60-inch screen and some very tasty armchairs.
So it's a lounge, effectively.
It's a sort of lounge.
It's not a cinema.
It's like a home cinema.
No, because a home cinema has to have proper home cinema seats.
I'm not sure about that.
Yeah, of course
not
it does.
Sure about that. My mate, actually, who's a Chelsea fan, lived down in Cobham.
Oh, yeah.
Two doors away from John Terry.
Yeah.
Has got a home cinema, and I went around there once to watch an Everton game away from home.
Yeah.
It wasn't Chelsea, obviously, because he's a season ticket holder at Chelsea.
Yeah.
And that was a proper home cinema, and it was in the basement, and it was pretty impressive, I have to say.
I bet. How about this from Rascual?
Mm-hmm.
He says, I have to say that Porky is no man of the people. He's a pompous, nasty Mr. Know-it-all, and 100% jealous of the great MG.
Who's that come from?
A guy called Rascual.
That person must be on ganja or something.
Why?
To think like that about me. Nobody thinks like that about me.
A lot of
me.
People do.
No, they
which
don't.
Is why it's even more curious that you ever win any winners and losers. I think you should check CCTV to see the mince pie being crushed, says Steve.
No, you won't find it.
I think
it,
we could call that up.
Nothing to do with me, honestly. I'd like the reaction, please, from our listeners to, do you really think that I'm capable of doing such a petty, you know, invoking such a petty act of sort of minor criminality?
Well, Scrooge-like behaviour at Christmas.
Well, I mean, I did ask you not to, and I think what I've done is I think I've inflamed the anger of a member of the production staff who, we go out in the breaks, right, at the top of the hour.
Yeah.
You saw me out there. I was out there, Mike. I don't know how you can
accuse
me.
Yeah, but you were back in here when I got back in.
Well, that's because I get into my seat when we're ready to broadcast again. You're rushing in from the fire exit where you've been having a quick cigarette.
No, absolutely not.
Did you have a quick cigarette?
In the smoking area, yeah.
There's no smoking area.
Yeah, there is. Mm. But I came in and you were already sitting here and all I could see in front of me was basically a crushed mince pie.
But did you see me anywhere near your seat?
If I was Hercule Poirot, I would...
Did you see me anywhere near your seat?
No.
No, of course not.
But you had plenty of time to do it.
Well, you've got witnesses through the glass there in the production
office. I'll just pull the CCTV footage, fine. I'll get Brian to do it.
Don't worry. Well, I hope you will because that will vindicate me. That will prove my innocence.
Okay. Were you wearing a mask? Mm.
What?
Were you wearing a mask?
No, I didn't. It was nothing to do with me. You know, look, I'm confident enough about... being in my own skin.
Boiled skin.
If I thought I'd done something wrong, I'd hold my hands up because I have no
fear. You're always doing that, aren't
you? I have no fear.
You're always admitting to things that you've done wrong.
Yes.
This is Talk Sport. We are the two bikes.
Driving experiences at Mercedes-Benz World are the perfect Christmas gift. From under 17s driving to 4x4 and high-performance AMG experiences on our handling circuits, there's something for everyone. Prices start at just £45. Call 0370 400 4000 or visit mercedes-benzworld.co.uk to buy yours today. Mercedes-Benz World at Brooklands, just off Junction 10 on the M25.
I know. The state pension is changing.
I know. How much you get will still depend on your national insurance record. And don't forget you may still have a private pension to consider too.
I know. I'll be able to see how much I'm likely to receive and understand what I can do to improve my state pension.
I know. If you reach state pension age on or after the 6th of April 2016, you'll be part of the new scheme.
Make sure you know the facts about the new state pension. Visit gov.uk/yourstatepension for more information.
Just can't wait for Christmas. At Argos, our up to half price gifting event is now on, with over 1,000 lines included. Plus, buy online and get fast track same day delivery for only £3.95. Go Argos. Ends Thursday, order by 6 p.m. Store stocked items only, excludes Christmas Day, 90% UK coverage. Terms and conditions apply.
Hey, should we get takeaway from Just Eat tonight?
Oh, do you know what? I need a Balti! I'm holding out for a Balti lamb ticket tonight. It's gotta be hot, and it's gotta be fresh, and it's gotta have mushroom fried rice.
Just Eat. Tap the app and get that mini fist pump feeling.
When you need all the latest form and odds on all the day's sporting action, and you need it fast, you need the Coral Daily Download. Get all the latest news and great offers on all the big games and all the biggest race meetings in one essential package. Delivered to your ears at the speed of sound. Don't miss the Coral Daily Download every morning on the Alan Brazil Sports Breakfast from 6 on Talk Sport with Coral. Your best bet for breakfast.
Talk Sport on DAB Digital Radio and 1089 and 1053 AM. The enduring home of football.
It's modern radio, only better.
Talk Sport.
Fun.
are the two mics. Ask Porky coming up very shortly. Do you know what we haven't done? We haven't worked out what we're going to do for the quiz on Thursday.
The quiz, yes.
Christmas Day quiz. It should be about Christmas, really.
Should be.
Any particular aspect of it?
Why don't we do... What about the three wise men?
The three wise men? That's a good one.
Yeah.
So a quiz on the three wise men.
Yes.
Excellent. Or the three kings, as some people call them.
Yeah, exactly. Same thing. Yeah.
All right.
Okay.
Excellent.
Right, that's great.
Here's one from Sapples who says, the mince pie was obviously bitter revenge for ruining Mike's chances with the girls on earlier.
No.
Brian says, yes, Mike Parry, I think you cheated on winners and losers. You couldn't win any other way.
Oh, no, I didn't. No, not at all. Believe me. I am a man who is of principle. Listen, I'll tell you what I'll talk to you about, right?
Yeah, go on.
Now, how many times have I moaned to you about the ridiculous state of speed limits on motorways in this country?
On a nightly basis, I would say.
In Germany...
Although yesterday you told me, did you not, that learner drivers are going to now be allowed on motorways, which I think it's going to make it worse.
No, it's a good thing, because at least they'll be able to put up with faster traffic when they eventually get their driving licence, which they can't at the moment. Now, what you didn't know, you see, and which I do, is that today is the anniversary of the moment in 1965 when the then Transport Minister, Ernest Marples... announced that we're going to have a temporary, and he stressed, you know, don't be frightened, motorists, you know, I'm not curtailing your right to drive at whatever speed you want on Britain's roads. This is a free country, but we must curtail the speeds on a temporary basis whilst we're going through our motorway building programme in order to assess the volume of traffic.
Oh, was this because that prior to that there was no speed limit?
There's no speed limit
so
at all.
So basically on a motorway you could drive any speed you wanted?
There was no speed limit at all, right? And the first bit of motorway in this country was not called a motorway. It was called the Preston Bypass.
Yeah.
Preston
We've
Relief
had this
Road.
Argument
Sorry.
Before, haven't we?
Preston Relief
Because
Road,
I've
yeah.
often said to you that the first bit of motorway that I know of was the first stretch of the M1 coming up from sort of Hendon up towards Watford.
It wasn't. It was the Preston Relief Road.
Because you know
Road,
what my dad used to tell me about that, and I think I used to remember it, because when they opened it, we used to go up to Scotland on it.
Yeah.
And they used to test drive Bristol cars on it.
Well, funny you should say that.
Who still have a showroom down in Kensington.
Another reason why they introduced this temporary speed limit in 1960 on this day in 1965 was because... apparently, although there's never been any pictures of it, Formula One motor racing teams would use the motorways very early on Sunday mornings in the summer when there's no traffic on them to test their cars and get up to speeds of 180 miles an hour.
Well, Bristol used to do that with their sort of... You know, they weren't selling Formula One cars. They were selling kind of sports cars
and
saloon cars and the fantastic engines in them. And they used to get up to about 180 miles an hour and the police didn't have cars fast enough to catch them.
No, that's right. Exactly. Mm. And so the point is, it was another contract by politicians. It was called the Temporary Speed Curtailment Act, okay?
Oh, yeah. Right.
And it limited to 70 miles an hour. Now,
and has it ever been sort of made permanent, you know, like officially? I mean, I know obviously it has been, you know, in everybody's minds.
Well, the point is, it didn't have to be, because you have to obey the road signs on motorways. That's statute. Mm. And if the road sign says it's got the black thing through it, that means maximum speed, but that's 70 miles an hour.
Yes.
Can't go faster than that.
Yeah, but it means you can't go over. What I'm saying is that you know how they ratify these you know, Acts of Parliament?
Yes.
Or they make them more permanent. I wonder if they've never done that.
I'm not sure whether they have or not. I don't know the answer to that one. But what I can tell you is this. I mean, that was all right when cars were like Mark 1 Cortinas, Morris Minors, Morris 1100.
But they had very fast cars in those days.
Austin Cambridges, you know, and all these kind of things. They were like rattled cans, you know. They were
Well, actually, I wouldn't say about the... Because my parents had an Austin Cambridge.
Yeah.
And that we used to regularly do over 70. And
I agree with that. But my dad had a Morris Minor. And I remember we went to the Cup Final in 1966.
Yeah.
So that was a year before this limit was imposed.
Yeah. Year after, no?
Sorry?
Year after.
No, year before. Oh, 65, year after, that's right. And my dad's car, it was a Morris Minor with, you know, all the wood around the back. Morris Minor Traveller, I think used to call it.
Oh, yeah, like the old shooting brake.
Shooting brake or something, And I remember, because it was quite new, his car. He used to get it every 2 years. He was a travelling salesman, or a commercial traveller, as they called him in those days, right? He sold brushes for Addis.
Right.
Addis is still going.
Yeah, I know.
You know.
Well, I told you I worked for the guy who was a descendant of that family.
Yeah, you're right. Yeah, Richard Addis,
Well, don't say his name.
And anyway, the point of my story is, I remember us going down the A41, because there were no motorways, really, much.
No.
There certainly wasn't a motorway all the way to the south.
But also, there weren't any cars.
There weren't any cars, no.
There was no congestion.
And we never got over 60 miles an hour because the car wouldn't go more than 60 miles an hour. You know, its maximum speed on the dial was 90 miles an hour. Yeah. But these days, you see, without boasting about my magnificent new Mercedes, which
well,
has
you
got
want to do that,
3.5-litre engine.
Is it really?
Yes. And
it's a very big engine.
It's a very big engine.
For a car like that.
Yeah, and it's...
That's a bigger engine than my Land Rover's got.
Well, exactly, but it's a two-door sports car. Yeah. And it floats like a magic carpet.
What does it go 0 to 60 in?
I don't know, because I don't actually do that. But what I do know
is... You must be able to find out.
Well, I suppose I could, but I mean, I'm not, you know, desperate to get away from the lights that fast. But what I'm saying is the other day when I was coming back from the coast, I wondered why everybody else around me was going so slow as I drifted by them all.
Right.
And I looked down at my speedometer to see I was going 110 miles an hour.
That's illegal.
Now, well, yeah, of course it is, yeah. Now, the point is...
Where are you doing this?
On the A3.
Right. Now, I felt... Well, there are a load of cameras on the A3.
No, there are...
Are you sure?
Well, there are cameras, but, I mean, you know where they are, if you see what
I mean. Yeah, but do you, though? Because they're now moving them around. And
well, if
also...
you're smart on the average bear, you do.
I've noticed what's happening is a lot of cameras are disappearing.
Yes.
But they're not actually disappearing. What they're doing is they're being replaced by taller cameras, which do not look like speed cameras.
Well, you can't spot the taller cameras because they're in the heavens.
So you might find that you've been done without noticing.
Well, anyway, the point of my story is...
I hope you have been done. You shouldn't be driving that fast.
Oh, that's nice. Thank you. So you hope I've been penalised.
No, you shouldn't be driving 110.
The point of my story...
Yeah, automatic ban.
Excuse me. The point of my story is I didn't intend to be travelling that fast, but because my car is so beautifully engineered, it was impossible to judge what speed I was doing.
Are you saying you're not in control of the car? That's what the cops would say.
No, no. I'm saying there is no vibration.
Yeah.
That the sound of the radio I was listening to did not alter with any sort of wind noise or anything like
that. Why would it?
Well, because in old-fashioned cars, the faster you went, the more wind resistance you got against the windscreen. And you had to turn the radio up.
Well, if you were driving in an open-top car, maybe.
Yeah. There was no increased sound of rubber on concrete or tarmac or anything like that. So I glanced down, I thought, oh, whoa, you're going too fast here, and I slowed down.
Well, surely the fact that you're passing everybody at the rate of knots would be a clue.
Well, I just thought they were driving very slowly because it was Sunday morning. Anyway, the point of my story is...
I find it's a shocking admission of yours.
Without a shadow of a doubt, you should be allowed to drive at 85 miles an hour on a motorway in my sort of car.
Yeah, but you're doing 110 already.
Yeah, but I didn't mean to be.
But ignorance is no excuse.
No, but what I'm saying is, don't you understand the relative engineering magnificence of cars today compared to cars in 65?
If you hit a bollard at 110 miles an hour, you're much more chance of dying, even if you're in a Mercedes, than if you hit it at 70.
You're not going to hit a bollard.
Well, you might do.
And the point
is... What if you have a blowout?
By the way, when my dad's car was going at 60 miles an hour, if I was driving alongside him 110 miles an hour. I bet you the brakes on my Merc are more efficient than the brakes ever were on a Morris Minor.
That may be true.
Right?
Yeah, but
so
still,
I would stop
still,
more quickly.
Yeah, but you might remember we gave you a highway code test.
Yes.
And we asked you what the stopping distance was at certain speeds. You got it completely wrong.
No, I didn't.
Yeah, you did.
No, I didn't.
You got it completely wrong.
No,
the conditions that we've got at the moment, which are very wet, slippery.
I agree.
You know, obviously, as you will know,
the
stopping distance increases by a factor of about 3 or 4.
Yeah. Now, can I just urge everybody, please, not to try driving around on motorways at 110 miles an hour.
Well, it's illegal.
It's illegal.
And there was a point at which, I mean, although some footballers seem to get away with it, was a point at which you'd get a ban automatically for going over 100.
Oh, I know you would, and you deserve one as well. I didn't mean to be doing that sort of speed.
That's no excuse.
But I couldn't help being in a magnificent car. And the point is...
Did you wave at all the peasants as you were going past them?
No, don't be silly. I mean, nothing like that at all. All I'm saying is that, you know, it is modern-day life. Cars are so efficient now that you really can't tell. You really can't tell.
Well, I don't believe that.
And you've got to raise the speed limit from 70. You have to, honestly. It's ridiculous. Do you know what I've worked out? Because I've done a financial and economical model.
What have you worked out?
That for every 5 miles an hour they increase the speed limit, the overall gross domestic product of this country would increase...
Would.
...by 25 billion a year.
Don't believe you.
25 billion.
No. The reason that... The
25 billion more wealth in this country if you put the speed limit up by 5 miles an hour to 75. 50 billion. No. 50 billion increase.
You're just making it up now.
Put it up to 80. If you put it up to 80. If we all travel at 10 miles an hour more, faster, we get to places quicker, we get more business done, more things happen during the day. the wealth of the country.
How about you just don't do business by travelling? You just do business online instead. Well, that way, some people don't have to worry about it.
Yes, but you have to do business when you're transporting 100,000 boxes of Maltesers from A to B.
Yeah, well, I don't want drivers of lorries going 180 miles an hour. Thanks
very
much.
Well, neither do I, but I think they should also be allowed to do 80 miles an hour.
Well, I don't think so.
Because lorries are the most stable vehicles on the road.
Don't be ridiculous.
They are, in my opinion.
Absolute rubbish.
And the lorry drivers are the king of the road. The lorry drivers are the king of the road.
It's another pathetic attempt at trying to get popularity, because you know there's lorry drivers listening.
No, no.
This is Talk Sport. Coming up next, it's time for Ask Porky. Perhaps you'd ask why he's such a sycophant.
No.
This is Talk Sport.
On DAB Digital Radio and 1089 and 1053 AM.
A terrific performance.
Turn of pace and eye for goal.
Shout about it.
Porky, every Tuesday night going into Wednesday morning. He's here to help. He can ask you questions about personal problems, financial problems.
Yes.
You know, just general global problems.
Yes.
You've got an answer for everything, really.
Yes.
We've got loads of questions on Facebook now on our page. If you haven't joined it yet, go and find the two mics on Facebook.
Mm-hmm.
And we've got loads that have come in on Twitter as well.
Yes.
Let's start off with one which is slightly festive, I suppose you might say. This is from Darren on Facebook. He says, Porky, I'm struggling with ideas of what to buy the wife for Christmas this year. What's the best and worst present you have received in the past? And he says, Merry Christmas.
Well, in the past, the best and worst presents are... The best present ever, of course, is to have the company of your family on Christmas Day, to have those that you love around you and those that love you around you. That is the best present. You cannot put a price on that. The worst present, isolation from the family on Christmas Day. On one particular occasion, I was in the Middle East on Christmas Day, couldn't get back home to the family, suffering, you know, the travails of covering a war, shells flying all over the place, danger imminent and in the air. Not much Christmas spirit there. That's the answer to that one.
So what about the worst present, though?
That is the worst present, having been away from the family, ripped out of the, you know, the bosom of my family on a Christmas Day.
I bet they didn't think that.
Oh, they did.
Now, how about this one from Tex? He says, what do you think of adults who get very excited about seeing the new Star Wars film?
I think it's a very good thing. I think that, A, it's very creative, and you've got to remember that this whole show that I do with Old Fatso here is based on creativity.
Old Fatso.
And whatever
I haven't
you
heard
say,
that one for a while.
Whatever you say about what we do, we are creative in our ability to try and bring communication powers to the millions of people who listen to us on Talk Sport. So I say, good for you. We should all get excited about things in life. We should all be able to go to the theatre and take ourselves out of this cruel, nasty and cold world that we live in into an era and aura of self...
era and aura?
An aura.
About Rita aura.
No, within... put ourselves into an arena is the word I was really looking for. Of somewhat fantasy, but in fact fantasy reflecting real life with our hopes and aspirations up there on the silver screen.
All right. I think you might have to ask you to be a bit more brief in your answers. I don't want to get through many of these. Right. John says on Facebook, Dear Porky, if the 12 Days of Christmas song was to be extended for an extra day, what would you send your true love on the 13th day?
On the 13th day, I would send my true love, my
Isn't
total...
Isn't it my true love sent to me?
Yes, my total adoration and devotion to all things good about the world. Yes.
Okay. Here's one from Kelly. Yes. Should the FA sound out Jose Mourinho for the England job before he gets appointed elsewhere?
No, not under any circumstances. The England job's a part-time job. We all know that now. That's obvious. Jose Mourinho's got far too much energy to be doing just 10 games a year. And I do not want anybody but an Englishman, personally, to be the England manager. So the answer's no.
Okay. Paul says, Porky, my father-in-law refuses to remove his shoes when entering my house.
Yes.
I've offered him slippers, but he refuses. Yes. I'd like to approach this issue with violence, but I fear this will annoy my wife. How can I ensure that he doesn't come round this Christmas trampling his dirty shoes on my living room floor?
Oh, you just tell him. You just slam the door in his face. You don't want that dirty old
git. Well, you just don't let him in.
Yeah, exactly. You don't want a dirty old git in your house. And say to your wife anyway, look, we have standards in this house. If your father can't live up to them, tell him to sling his hook. Tell him to go down to the pub on the corner of the road in the worst part of town. Spit and sawdust seems to be about right for a man with no manners.
OK. Here's one from George. Dear Porkmeister, what is the maximum amount of cash a man should spend on a first date, brackets, meal and drinks, without expecting some intimate favours from the person involved? He uses a different word, which I'm not going to use.
Yes.
A friend of mine spent 70 quid on one a couple of weeks ago and got nothing, and he's been moaning about it constantly since.
Yeah, well, that guy's a jerk, because anybody who spends only £70 on romancing a lady, expecting maybe the romance...
Surely
you
should have taken it to the Four Seasons for a bit of room service.
Yeah, I totally agree. You know, to expect a £70 night out to result or end up in a romantic Closetness is a false hope in this life. I'm afraid your mate is a cheapskate. He's also a chancer and a dreamer and unworthy of a decent woman.
OK. Here's one from Adam. This is very topical. Porky, what time is the right time to start drinking on Christmas Day?
On Christmas Day, I always announce to the family that the bar is open at 11 o'clock. And that's when the champagne... A.M., yes, obviously.
Well, so that's quite late for you, isn't it?
Well, the point is...
You normally open a bar every day before that.
No. The point is that everybody has to get up and get showered and get themselves sorted. And my mum in particular likes to do a big breakfast on Christmas Day so we can eat late in the afternoon at 4 o'clock, if you see what I mean. Also,
good idea to get some sort of roughage
in
you, isn't it?
Yes, well, also, after breakfast, we always go to the pub anyway. so we always have a livener in the house at 11.
Yeah.
We're in the pub at 11.30.
Okay.
We come back at 12.30.
Right.
And then...
You must be completely bladderated by the time you have Christmas dinner.
Though. Usually are. Yeah, yeah.
So that's a good thing.
Yes.
Here's one from Frazzle. He says, I'm going to put a romantic Christmas message in the Times personal ads for Mrs. Frazzle.
Yes.
Should I mention her lingerie?
Well, that's entirely up to you. I mean, that's a very personal thing, isn't it? As long as you express your love and devotion to the woman who is the love of your life, that's the main thing. You can do that in a number of ways. You can either do it with a bit of the old sexy chat, or you can be adoring in your tribute.
OK. Here's one from Brucey. Which act of rat-like cunning are you most proud of?
There have been a few rat-like cunning ones. You've all heard of the Rudolf Nureyev one. But, I mean, in many other instances, I helped catch the Yorkshire Ripper with a bit of rat-like cunning by pretending to be a police officer when I rang his house to make sure it was his house and it was him. So there have been many, many instances, but I don't like to boast about them.
OK, here's one from Sean, who says on Facebook, Dear Porky, is it acceptable to buy someone a Christmas present with high street vouchers you received as a present from work, or is this skinflint behaviour?
No, that's not skinflint behaviour. That's called opportunism. That is a bit of rat-like cunning, actually. If you get the vouchers from work, pass them on to people, and that saves yourself a few bob and also makes you popular.
Now, here's
it's a good thing. Good thing.
Here's a science question for you. I don't know whether you'll be able to answer this one, because I'm not sure I could. Abandoned says this. How is there a constant supply of oxygen to breathe up in the orbiting International Space Station?
Because it's in bottles and they feed it through the system.
So there can't be a constant supply then, can
there? Yeah, there is a constant supply.
It must be a finite supply.
No.
Eventually it must run out.
No, they manufacture oxygen in space.
Do they?
You can do that.
So they make it actually out of the space station?
Well, you know, there's no atmosphere in space, so there's no gases to suck in.
Well, there's no gravity anyway.
No gravity. So you can manufacture oxygen in space, not a problem.
Yeah, okay.
I know this.
Here's one from Wayne.
Yes.
He says, Porky, me and the wife have said we aren't going to buy each other anything this year.
Yeah.
I've kept to the promise while she has gone out and bought me loads of stuff.
Yeah.
Do I take the gifts and say thanks and keep to the deal and give her nothing, or do I actually make an effort and just give her some money like I do every year?
Well, I think you're a miserable git and a miserable individual. Honestly, your wife clearly, you know, wants to be affectionate, she wants to be part of a partnership, she goes out and does it to surprise you. If you didn't anticipate that, know she's going to do it, you shouldn't be married to this very kind and loving woman. And in fact, if I was
Hang on, they've done a deal where they said we're not going to buy Christmas presents for each other.
Yeah, but you do that. My mum always says, oh, don't buy me anything for Christmas. If we woke up on Christmas Day and there was nothing there for her, she would sulk off, she'd slope off and sulk for the rest of the day.
Quite right.
So you should have anticipated that your wife wanted something. She doesn't deserve you. Tell your wife that if she feels lonely on Christmas Day, because she's booted you out, she knows where the portmeister is.
Indeed, and you'll be more than happy to comfort her in a time of distress, right? Kelly says, when did the portmeister last do a good deed, and what was it?
A number of good deeds. Old MG and I did send a donation to the poor families in Cumbria to help
them.
By
the way, the poor things are getting flooded again tonight.
Getting flooded again. Yeah. It's a very, very sad situation. Also, of course, I did support a charity, Julia's House, in Bournemouth, in penance for doubting that Bournemouth would be promoted. And in addition to that, an awful lot of charitable donations, which I don't like to talk about on air, but I do it behind the scenes because I feel it's my responsibility to help others.
What a hero.
Yes.
Here's one from Carl, who says, actually, he's got two questions. The first one's a joke, obviously, so I'll read it out anyway. He says, Porky, my wife asked me what I wanted for Christmas.
Yes.
I told her I'd settle for a Frombie. She's since Googled it to see where she can find one. Do I let her in on it? Never mind that. Well, the real question is, Porky, Tranmere play Macclesfield Town away on Boxing Day. Do I purchase a seat on the Bladderation bus and watch the Mighty Rovers, or do I spend the time in the bosom of my family?
Oh, no, I'd go and watch that one. I think Boxing Day football's brilliant. I really do. The only problem is that my team this year is playing at Newcastle. I'm going to be in Bournemouth on Christmas Day. that is the longest journey in the world. We tried to look at a flight from Southampton up to Newcastle on Boxing Day. I was going to go with my nephew, but we couldn't actually find one. So that we've
there's nothing
that
near
one.
Enough.
No, no. Well, Bournemouth's got an airport. Southampton's got an airport, but we couldn't find a flight. I'm afraid.
I see. Okay.
But no, I'm all for people going out on Boxing Day to sporting events. The old King George race is on Boxing Day, isn't it?
It is.
Yes.
Well, here's one from Jared. You might like this one. He says, Porky, a mate and I are headed over from Wyoming to catch a number of matches around London.
Wow.
Our wives think we are going to be gone for a week when it will actually be two. Yes. How do we let them know?
Oh, that's easy. You just talk about the incompetence of European airlines and their ability to get things right. In my experience, having lived in America for many years and had an association with them, everything works in America. Problem is, Europeans have such a strange way of life, going to sleep in the afternoon, siestas and all that kind of stuff. It often breaks down here. Just tell your wives that the French air traffic controllers are on strike, the Spanish were having a siesta, the Italians had too much Pina Grigio, it all got too much, and they were delayed 4 days getting back.
Bizarrely, that'll probably work, actually. Here's one from Gaul, who says, my girlfriend's birthday is on Boxing Day. Is there any suggestions from Porky on how to make it about her and not Christmas?
Yes.
Presumably by not going to the football.
No, what you do is, it's easy. Christmas Day is Christmas Day. When your, was it girlfriend? Or
girlfriend,
or
yeah.
Girlfriend comes down on Boxing Day, you replace the fairy on the top of the tree with an image of your girlfriend looking beautiful on the top of the tree.
On the top of a tree?
Yes, on
the
top of the tree.
Like a picture?
Yes, no, a little model. You get a model made of your girlfriend.
How do you get that done?
Well, you get a caricature of a face and stick it on the face of a doll.
Mm.
And you stick it on top of the tree. And then when she walks through the door, as she emerges on the
day, sees herself impaled on the tree.
Yes, you start seeing,
she may or may not be delighted.
Happy birthday to you. Boxing dinner and stew. Happy birthday, dear Angela. Happy birthday to you.
It's uncanny. How did you know her name was Angela?
Well, I'm just guessing.
Richard says this. He says he's a Villa fan. Will Villa actually win anything game-wise? Will they win a game in 2016?
I think they might not. They've got such a pathetic return on points that I don't think anybody's ever survived being this low down at Christmas. And the problem with a situation like that is, as each game goes by, confidence saps and saps and saps and saps away. You will be lucky to win a game again this season. It was particularly funny to hear Remy Gard, their manager, saying 10 victories and we'll be clear.
Yeah.
10 victories, we'll be clear.
That's an awful lot of victories.
You've got one so far and half a season's gone.
I know. Right, final question. Porky says, Andy, on Facebook, do I get bladderated Christmas Day and Boxing Day, leaving the wife to do all the driving, or do I take a turn and have a day sober?
Well, that depends on the relationship between you and your wife. It's very unfair to say to the wife, right, you've got to be sober for a couple of days so I can get bladderated. So my suggestion is, put your hand in your pocket, get yourself organised with a taxi for Boxing Day at least, so that you can both go out and enjoy the bladderation trail on the festive season.
See, that is the problem, isn't it, for old for things like Boxing Day and Christmas Day and New Year's Eve and New Year's Day.
Yes.
Getting taxis is a nightmare. We're going to talk about that.
Yeah, it is, yeah. I agree. But you've got to book in advance, you see.
Yeah, I know, but even then.
So you've got to be like me. You've got to plan your life in advance, not just wait until it happens.
Yeah, but even then, because I've got a question for you, actually,
about
that. That was Ask Porky. There'll be another one same time, actually not the same time next week. It'll be next week during the afternoon on the Hawksby and Jacobs slot. This is TalkSport.
We took the all-new Mitsubishi L200 Series 5 across the globe for 18 days and 4,267 miles. We conquered the Sahara Desert and the Atlas Mountains to show the world the most manoeuvrable, economic, efficient, safest and capable pickup we've ever made. The Mitsubishi L200 Series 5, showing the world how it's done. Search Mitsubishi L200 and test the best.
The best ever DFS winter sale is now on, with savings on every sofa in store. You can choose the exact style, fabric and colour that best suits your home. And because every sofa is handmade to order and comes with a 10-year guarantee, you know your sofa will be at its best for years to come. Which sofa will you fall for in the best ever DFS winter sale? Doors open 9 a.m. Boxing Day. Not present APR representative.
Colin Murray, weekday mornings from 10 on TalkSport with Wicks. Every weekday morning, get opinionated comment.
So excited, only three Leeds United managers until Christmas.
Exclusive interviews.
Jimmy Carragher.
Well, I had him by the throat, never mind shouting at him.
An unmissable debate.
You've backed yourself into a wall now, Cole, if you don't mind me saying so.
From the biggest names in sports broadcasting every day.
As always, you take this show on to a new level.
There ain't no listeners like the TalkSport listeners.
Colin Murray, weekday mornings from 10 on TalkSport with Wicks. Let's do it right.
So, it's the most wonderful time of the year, is it?
It's the most wonderful time of the year.
Not round here, it isn't.
Yes, I'm doing it!
Christmas 2015 on Talk Sport.
I have to say, I went to see Star Wars, the new movie.
Oh, now how was it?
Force Awakens, took the kids on Sunday.
Yes, yes.
It was great, absolutely great.
I thought you said the first 20 minutes was very slow.
Well, I didn't say it was slow, I just thought as I was watching it...
No, you did say it was
slow. No, as I was watching it, I wasn't sure because everyone had said this is the most fantastic movie you've ever seen.
Yes.
Greatest Star Wars film you've ever seen. And because it had a sort of a new cast and new characters, I was watching it and I was thinking, well, this is okay. But it wasn't kind of, you know... getting me very excited. It wasn't floating my boat, as you say. But then it became slightly more familiar. Some of the more familiar characters came in.
Right.
And it was great. Everybody really liked it. And everybody really enjoyed it.
Was the cinema packed?
Funnily enough, it wasn't.
Where was it?
First of all, I went to see it in London.
Right.
Because the kids wanted to come up to London to see it. And when I went to buy the tickets, I think it was on Friday morning.
Yes.
I thought, because I hadn't been able to get them online, and I thought, there's no way I'm going to be able to get tickets for this weekend.
Right.
And I went in, and there was a guy wearing a Darth Vader mask selling tickets.
Right.
Which I found slightly off-putting.
Yeah,
I said that to him.
What was his voice like?
Yeah, his voice was fine, but he had this mask on, which was slightly small for his face as well. And I said to him...
big face, small mask.
Big face, small mask. I said, I'm terribly sorry, you're slightly putting me off with that mask. He says, yeah, I'm sorry about that. He said, I have to wear it.
Yes.
And I said, well, you know, do you not get very hot in it? He says, yeah, I have to take it off every 10 minutes because it's like, you know, suffocating.
Yeah, exactly.
But anyway, so they sold me some tickets and there's my daughter and her fiancé along as well. And I thought, well, we better get in there early because they were unallocated seats.
Exactly.
And I know that somebody like you would probably buy the premium seats, right? Yeah, but I don't believe in doing that.
Indeed.
I think it's a waste of money.
Yeah.
So I thought we weren't going to get five seats together. And lo and behold, walked into the place about 10 minutes before the programme was due to start. It was completely empty.
Completely empty?
Completely empty.
Which cinema was this?
It was at Surrey Quays, the Odeon.
Oh, okay, yeah. Well, I found that astonishing.
I mean, it was. Obviously, as time went on, it filled up, but it wasn't completely and utterly rammed.
I mean, that's pretty good news because I might now go and see it.
I'm sure you'd be able to.
I cannot sit in an overpacked theatre.
No.
There's just too many people around me to give me bad vibes.
I mean, the problem is,
it is
now school holidays, of course. So
sorry?
It is now the school holidays, so you might find it a little bit busy.
Yeah.
Now, how about this from Matt,
right,
who says, here's an excerpt from this week's quiz. MG, how many wise men were there? MP, thinking aloud, two.
No,
I don't think you're going to get that one wrong.
I got that one
Mark
right.
says, I totally agree with Mr. Parry. He is correct. My Jag XF was the same, far quieter than a peasant Fiesta.
Yes, I totally agree. I had three XF Jags, and they're exactly the same.
Lee says, Porky, that is driving without due care and attention, 110 miles an hour, and you have admitted it.
Yeah.
Hashtag buffoon.
No, but what I'm saying is, I wasn't aware I was doing that. I didn't say to myself, right, I'm going to go 110 miles an hour. I literally glanced down at the speedometer, and I thought, wow. And I didn't put my foot on the brake. That might have caused an accident.
Yeah.
I immediately took my foot off the accelerator, and the car whined down to the legal speed.
Now, by the way, did you see the story today about Norman Wisdom? I've been meaning to mention this one.
What about it?
Well, apparently, the BBC website, by accident, put out a story saying that Norman Wisdom had died.
Well, that's true. He died
5 years ago. Yeah. But apparently, so many people didn't realise that he was dead.
Yes.
That they put all sorts of, you know, best wishes, condolences,
tributes,
messages, and tributes on their website.
Yeah. He was a bit of a character, old Norman Wisdom.
He was.
Lived in the Isle of Man.
He did.
Right.
Died there in 2010, aged 95.
Is that right? Yeah. Mm. But a friend of mine who lives over in the Isle of Man had an interest in the island tours, like a bus that you go on and, you know, took you around.
What was there to see in the Isle of Man?
Well, there's loads of historical sites, actually. Yeah, Vikings.
I've never been there.
Oh, yeah, the Isle of Man's great. I love the Isle of Man. It's like going back
But like, what would you see, though? In a bus?
It's like going around Hollywood, is it?
Well, there are all sorts of things,
believe me. It's like going back to 1950s England, a lot of it. And there's, you know, Douglas is the main town, I think.
Yeah.
And Ronald's Way is the airport. We flew in there once.
Well, yeah, but it's not much. You're not getting me going so far.
No, it is. It's great.
I mean, it's not like they've got an Eiffel Tower.
No, it's very historic, though. But anyway.
And they've got cliffs. Hey? It's quite flat, isn't it, the Isle of Man?
No, it's quite hilly.
Is it?
It's quite hilly, yeah. You can walk around it a lot, up and down hills and things, yeah. But anyway, the point is that the bus driver always phoned ahead to Norman Wisdom's... Was it Norman Wisdom?
Norman Wisdom.
Not Norman Vaughan.
Norman Vaughan?
Norman Vaughan was the other Norman, wasn't he?
Well, there's the other Normans that invaded Britain in 1066. No, you think of them?
Norman Vaughan was the guy who used to appear...
Norman Hunter?
..at the London Palladium, right?
Yeah.
And then later became famous for, ooh, roses grow on you. Do you remember that advert?
I remember the advert.
Yeah, was that Norman Vaughan? That was Norman Vaughan.
Was it to do with Johnny Vaughan?
No, nothing to do with Johnny Vaughan. I don't know, maybe Johnny Vaughan's a relation, but yeah. I didn't think he was.
Okay.
Anyway, the point of my story is, so the bus driver on the Isle of Man, who's shown people the historic sites and all that, used to have to ring ahead to Norman Wisdom's house 5 minutes before the bus was going to pass his house, because he was on the route map with one of the sites.
Yeah.
And that was so he could come out and then do his famous falling over walk in the garden.
Really?
Yeah, seriously. For all the tourists who...
even when he was in his 80s?
Even when he was in his 80s.
Blimey.
Yeah, seriously. And the tourists couldn't believe it. And then the deal was, the bus driver drive past, oh, yeah, we often see Norm. Like, oh, can we stop? And then the bus would turn round, come back.
And suddenly he would appear.
And he would appear, and they'd all have their pictures taken with Norman Wisdom.
Right.
He loved it.
But they all thought it was just a sort of by chance happening.
Yes, that's right. The bus driver used to say he practices his falling down routines every day.
Right.
And if you're lucky, when we pass, you know, you might just see, oh, look, there he is.
And the strangest thing about Norman Wisdom, of course, which is now well known, but wasn't for a long time, is he's a sort of folk hero in Albania.
He
and got all kinds of statues to him in Albania.
Old Hos, was it Hoxnia? Hoxnia, who was the dictator of Albania.
Yeah, said, I think it was a slightly different pronunciation.
I think it was Hoxnia. He said, no Western films in Albania, and the only one that got smuggled through was Norman Wisdom.
Yeah.
And instead of telling the secret police to go and lock up people for 30 years if they watched Norman Wisdom, he had a look at one himself and decided this man was a true working-class hero because he wore a flat cap. He was a milkman in the film that he first saw, so he was a working man and all this kind of stuff.
Yeah.
And he was a blithering idiot.
Yes.
And he wanted all his Albanian national people to be exactly that, blithering idiots who didn't question authority.
Amazing.
And when they did, to be subservient to authority. Mm. So he allowed Norman Wisdom films into the country.
Yeah.
Yeah, pretty good.
Now, here's this one from Lumpy, who says, hi, MG, Porky has lost the plot. He wants trucks to do 80 miles an hour.
Yeah.
Has he tried to stop a 44-tonner at speed? I'm a trucker. 60 miles an hour is quite sufficient.
Yeah, but they're incredibly engineeringly efficient trucks, aren't
they? Yeah, I know,
but I mean,
I still get very nervous when trucks start speeding and they go more than 70 miles an hour and they overtake you and you're, say, stuck between two lorries on a motorway. Yeah. I don't think it's a very
nice
thing.
I will concede on that because I am not an expert on trucks. And if that guy's a truck driver, what's his name again?
Lumpy.
Lumpy, thank you for contacting us. I will concede that you've got to, put a maximum speed on trucks.
Yeah.
But for cars, it's ridiculous to have a car driving only at 70 miles an hour on roads that can easily cope with faster speeds and cars that can certainly cope with faster speeds.
Well, Tat says that is why a 1.4 is best to drive, because big cars are too good now. A 1.4 you can drive, that is what Top Gear was telling us. Get a mid-range Citroën.
Mm. Well,
because
if you want a mid-range Citroën, that's fine.
I mean,
if you
think about that, I mean, I've got this massive Land Rover, right, which is a 2.7-litre engine, I think, which moves pretty fast.
Yes.
Now, your car must literally go twice that, in terms of acceleration.
It's incredibly fast.
You don't really need it to be that fast.
No, you don't, but you've got to be incredibly careful how much pressure you put on the accelerator, because you could get yourself into trouble. And it takes a couple of days to get used to it, and then you're used to it. But what it's brilliant for is for, A, getting you out of trouble, and B, you know, you've seen the moment when you pull out on the motorway and you think, wow, the open road ahead, and whoosh, you're away, you know. There's nothing wrong with that at all.
No, I mean, it's very handy when you can use acceleration to get away from a bad situation.
Yeah, exactly, that's what I'm saying.
I just think you have to be very careful. Neil says, MG, I drive a truck in Canada, which is 130 foot long, and I can drive it only at 64 miles an hour.
Mm.
Trucks should be allowed to drive faster.
Mm.
Well, I'm sorry, I'm
maybe.
Not with you on that.
No.
How about this one from, where is it? Where is it?
Go on.
I can't find it now.
Yeah. Okay, there's one here from Florida Roger, and it says, Porky, what would be your advice to Donald Trump should he lose the elections?
Yes. This is post Ask Porky, so I suppose you can still answer it.
Yeah, I suppose I can. My advice to Donald Trump is, look, you've shaken everything up, now stand down, because the idea of him being president is ludicrous.
It is
it?
Rather, yeah. Did you see what he said about Putin the other day? He was on TV yesterday.
Yes.
He said
he's the greatest flag bearer for ISIS, did he?
Well, he said, you know, this guy who I don't know, meaning Vladimir Putin, comes out and says, Donald Trump's a great guy.
Yeah.
He says, Donald Trump's a leader.
Yeah.
You know, and then he starts heaping praise on Putin and saying that, you know, Putin hates Obama, Obama hates Putin.
Yeah.
He says, wouldn't it be better if we all got along?
Yeah.
And therefore, I'm the man to lead the country.
Yes.
Oh, it's quite frightening, really, isn't it?
Well, yeah, but I mean, you know, a lot of people believe in what he's saying. Sorry, it was Hillary Clinton who said Donald Trump is the greatest rallying cry for members of ISIS join up.
Yeah. That may well be.
Yeah.
This is what I was looking for. Bill says, Mike Parry, would you like to come shark fishing with me? I've run out of bait.
Oh, it's very funny indeed.
It is funny, isn't it?
Would you ever get into one of those cages that go under the water and then watch sharks coming towards you?
No.
I would neither.
I have no interest. I'll tell you what, I would quite like to do a bit of scuba diving, which I've never done.
Yeah, I did that in St. Lucia.
Did you?
I took a scuba diving lesson in a scuba diving school because the chef at the hotel I stayed at was an expert scuba diver.
Okay.
And he told me to give me a free lesson.
What were the three main reasons, things you have to do if you're going to scuba dive then?
What do you mean?
Well, what do they teach you?
Well, it teaches you to put a mask on and breathe through a hose in your mouth.
So why do you need a lesson then?
Well, because you need to know things like how long your oxygen will last.
And how long does it last?
Well, I don't know.
You
really.
Didn't have a lesson, did you?
I did, yeah,
You're
I did.
You cobblers.
No, I did.
You're talking rubbish.
I did. I sat on the bottom of the sea.
You sat on the bottom of the sea?
Yeah.
Well, did you have those lead boots on?
Well, no, it was only about 8 foot deep, I admit. But the point is, it was the sea.
8 foot deep, you couldn't sit on the bottom of it either.
Hey?
You can only sit on the bottom of the sea if part of you is above the sea.
No.
You cannot sit at the bottom of the sea unless you're wearing heavy clothing.
No,
otherwise, you float back up.
No, I did. I was hanging
on. What were you wearing?
I was hanging on to the base of the pier.
The base of the pier?
Yeah.
Which pier?
Well, in St. Lucia.
What pier have they got there, then?
Well, it's not a pier. It's like a... It's what's it called? It's where the boats tie up.
You mean
jetty? Jetty. That's the
one.
You
didn't learn very many of the terms, did you?
Yeah, no, I did.
You sure you didn't just go snorkeling?
What?
You sure you didn't just go snorkeling?
No, I did a bit of snorkeling as well, but I didn't like snorkeling because my snorkeling pipe used to fill up with water. It used to go in my mouth.
Well,
I didn't like
to blow it out.
Well, I don't know. I must have got it wrong.
Was it one of those ridiculously round, old fashioned ones with a ping pong ball?
Might have been. I don't know. I didn't take it.
See,
very
I don't
well.
Think listen, you're not convincing me you did any of this stuff.
See, my problem is I can't open my eyes underwater. So unless I've got a mask on, I can't see anything. So
well, you're supposed to wear the mask.
Yeah, I know. Yeah, but
how about goggles?
Goggles? No, goggles are a bit old fashioned now. All the top guys wear masks.
Do they?
But
you're taking time, by the way.
But I was turned on to snorkeling.
By Timothy Leary?
No, to scuba diving.
Turned on to snorkeling,
No, when I was about 10, I came out of the film Thunderball and decided I was going to be a snorkeler.
What?
No, not a snorkeler, a scuba diver.
Oh, yeah? Why?
Yeah. Well, it looked so glamorous, didn't it?
Well, because of Ursula Andress.
Yeah, exactly, yeah.
Well, she had a bikini and a knife.
She was
Dr. No.
She was in Dr. No.
Yeah.
I'm talking about Thunderball.
Well, who was in a scuba suit in that then?
James Bond, and I mean, all the big fights in Thunderball were under the water.
Yeah, yeah.
They all had spear guns. I fancy getting a spear gun, actually.
Yeah, I fancy a spear gun as well.
Yeah.
Let's see who I'd shoot with it.
Yeah.
This is Talk Sport. More from the Porkmeister coming up tomorrow, of course, because it's time for Porky Vision, one of the highlights of the week. And in a Porky quiz, as we have decided on Thursday, on Christmas Day morning, will be about the three kings, or the three wise men.
Three wise men.
Well, the same thing.
Gold, frankincense and myrrh. That's the answer to question one.
Yeah, OK. Mm. It's the first one you've ever got right.
If you love the Two Mics podcast, you'll love the live show. Weekday overnights from 1 a.m. on DAB Digital Radio and 1089 and 1053 a.m. And via the TalkSport app. TalkSport, your Premier League station with exclusive commentaries every weekend.
What an absolute corker.
TalkSport.
This country's going to hell in a handcart.
Look at the light.